Live is next on the Liberty Radio Network. You're listening to the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.fm.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Darryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 29th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.71 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,188 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $238. Antiwar.com reports the northern Syrian city of Arhiha, the last government-held city of the Idlib province, fell yesterday to al-Qaeda's Nusra Front and its allies, giving them effective control over the entire province. The attack on the city near the Turkish border began earlier in the day with the fall of military checkpoints around the city. Syrian state media reported heavy fighting inside the city. Later, the Syrian government confirmed that the city fell outright, saying the military had moved to defensive positions outside the city after an influx of a large number of Nusra fighters. Pre-war, the city had about 80,000 people, and it lies along a key supply route between Idlib and the coastal Latakia province. Nusra has already made some attempts at Latakia as well, and this will likely make such an offensive easier.
For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
UPI reports protesters gathered at six interior border checkpoints in Arizona on Wednesday, where residents argue Border Patrol officials have turned their hometowns into militarized zones. At the Aravica checkpoint, about 35 miles south of Tucson, up to 20 Border Patrol agents were stationed to await the estimated 75 protesters who demand the removal of the checkpoints. Some checkpoints are up to 100 miles away from the border. Patty Miller, an area resident for over 30 years, said through Megaphone, "It seems like a war zone all the time." The organized protest by independent border town community groups focused on issues ranging from the environmental effects of border fences to a checkpoint's intrusion on Native American tribal land. The Aravica checkpoint was established 8 years ago and is the smallest of 11 checkpoints in the Tucson sector. Another protester told the media, "This checkpoint serves as a deterrent to living in Aravica." Manuel Padilla, chief patrol agent of the Border Patrol in the Tucson sector, was at the Aravica checkpoint and said checkpoints like these help secure Arizona and monitor illegal immigration. He added, "It's legal to run the checkpoints. If someone has a disagreement with the law, there are channels to express that."
You can support FPP Radio by shopping online. Whether you're looking for precious metals, bitcoins, or books, you'll find that and more at shop.fppradio.com. Or you can shop directly from FPP with Bitcoin in the Bitcoin store. Every purchase you make from one of my affiliates at shop.fppradio.com helps fund FPP Radio.
Reuters reports former Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives, Dennis Hastert, was indicted on Thursday on federal charges, including for lying to the FBI relating to an alleged effort to hide $3.5 million in payments he was making to a person to conceal past misconduct. The U.S. Attorney's Office in Chicago said the Illinois Republican, who left Congress in 2007, was charged with structuring the withdrawal of $952,000 in cash to evade the requirements that bank report transactions over $10,000 and lying to the FBI about the withdrawals. Each count of the two-count indictment carries a maximum penalty of 5 years in prison and a $250,000 fine. Hastert resigned on Thursday from the Dickstein Shapiro law firm in Washington, where he was listed as a senior advisor, and from the board of the exchange operator CME Group Incorporated, according to representatives of both the law firm and CME. Hastert could not be reached immediately to comment on the indictment. According to the indictment, the unspecified misconduct involved payments to an unnamed individual who had been a Yorkville, Illinois resident and had known Hastert for most of the person's life. According to the indictment, Hastert met with the person several times around 2010 and discussed past misconduct by the former lawmaker. Eventually, Hastert agreed to pay the person $3.5 million in compensation to conceal the misconduct. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
We turn to Washington, D.C., where America's roommates are holding a rally as part of their new One Vote Doesn't Matter political action campaign. The rally, which drew thousands of roommates, ranging from the guy who keeps all of his groceries in his room to the guy whose name the lease is under, is just a part of a surging grassroots movement to spread the message that one person's vote can't make a difference if you really, really think about it.
You know, this is like the most important election of our lifetime. We just want to get the word out that it's already been f***ing decided in some smoke-filled boardroom. You know, I pretty much minored in poli-sci, so I think I get this stuff.
Joining us now is Jason Copeland at a rally in the nation's capital. Jason, how would you describe the energy there?
Hi, Andrea. I'd say it's a definite chill vibe. I just saw the roommate whose only friend seems to be his younger brother and the guy who just has an air mattress in his room passing out flyers together. Now, the roommates do make some interesting points. The Electoral College is, it is weird.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We've got Skype. Skype on into the show here tonight at username lrn.fm. And tell us, well, you can tell us anything you want. That is the point of Free Talk Live. But tell us how you feel after this Ross Ulbricht verdict has come down. And as was predicted by the federal prisoner, whose letter we read earlier this week on these very radio waves, as he predicted, the judge gave Ross Ulbricht, the man who is admitted to having been the creator of the Silk Road, the world's most renowned, infamous,
notorious
drug website, underground marketplace. He sold not just drugs, but there was fake IDs and hacking tools and some questionable stuff there.
There were also books, like legally, you know, printed, lawful to own books that were sold on there.
So he's been found guilty. Of course, we knew that. That happened earlier this year. But sentenced today in the same federal court by the same awful, tyrannical judge.
Forrest Grump.
Judge Forrest is her last name. To life in prison with no possibility of parole. So here we are. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. And joining you in the studio tonight, by the way, it's Ian here.
Danica.
And Darryl.
All right. So obviously this is, it's on a lot of people's minds right now. People in the liberty movement who care about ending the insane war on drugs and who can recognize that what Ross Ulbricht did was heroic. Despite all the apologies he made to the judge in the letter that he wrote, and I guess that letter was delivered to the court within the last couple of weeks. We read it earlier this week here on Free Talk Live. Despite the tearful apology and bending over backwards to try to do everything they could to reduce the sentence, including having 100 letters written by people as diverse as the to include the people that he was actually in jail with, in the holding system, or whatever you want to call it. Let me get into the story here from Wired.com. Andy Greenberg has been following this case since before it was a case. It was Andy Greenberg who got the first interview with Dread Pirate Roberts. And this was probably in mid-2013, so before the site was taken down. It was taken down in, I think it was October of 2013.
Yeah.
Yep. Yes.
And then, of course, in November of 2013, Silk Road 2.0 launched with a, you know, real thumb in the or a finger in the face of the federal government. And of course, now there are more black market websites than ever before. There are more listings on those sites in total than ever before. And so, for all the money and the time and the effort, and now the money they're going to be spending putting him in prison, for all the effort that has been expended on this, there's more drugs available than ever.
So much for a sentencing being a warning to other dealers.
Well, yeah, they definitely want to send a message, as the judge will say.
It seems as though whenever the federal government declares war on something, there's more of that thing. There's been the war on poverty going on for nearly 50 years. Mm-hmm. There's more people that are in poverty now than there were 50 years ago.
Yep.
The war on drugs, and there's more people using drugs and selling drugs and manufacturing drugs
and
now.
And harder drugs.
than there. Right. And a lot of the, you know, harder drugs were created because of the war on drugs.
Like crack.
Synthetic cannabis, which is 20 times worse than cannabis, and I would dare say probably as bad as like heroin, is only a thing because cannabis was made illegal.
I don't know if it's as bad as heroin, but synthetic cannabis is definitely
you
something
you smoke
that...
enough of it, it's going to kill you.
And so, if anything, I'm sure it's going to kill you.
From what I've heard, the reason people will smoke more of it is because it delivers a different kind of high. So they don't realize that they're getting high, and then they're like, oh, now I'm high, and I've already smoked a lot of it.
Darryl, it depends. So synthetic cannabis is...
It smells like burnt plastic. That's pretty much all I know about it.
Synthetic cannabis is sort of a generic term that encompasses all kinds of different chemical configurations. And so it's hard to say what synthetic cannabis does, right? There are different brands, there's different tweakings to the chemical structure of this product, and that can result in some very different experiences. So, I mean, I've had a couple of experiences, probably about three experiences with so-called synthetic cannabis. The first one was at the Porcupine Freedom Festival a few years ago when a new mover at that time offered me some of this synthetic cannabis. And I'd never tried it before. And I thought, oh, you know, I've heard about this. I'll give it a try. And that was fine. I got a very similar stone to what I would get off of regular cannabis. It did have a lot of the same properties to it. Then later on, I tried some other supposed synthetic cannabis, and I nearly tripped on that. I took like two hits and felt that I had started tripping and stopped at that point because I had not intended to trip on smoking what it was supposed to ape cannabis. Right now, cannabis is it's a mild psychedelic in its natural form. So whatever they did to tweak the THC molecule definitely made it more than mild in this particular structure that I consumed with our former Tuesday night co-host Rich Paul a couple of years ago. So I would say there is a wide variety of products out there that call themselves synthetic cannabis. But you may have things to say about this Ross Ulbricht situation. We definitely want to go to you and your thoughts. So let's start, and I don't know what you're calling about, but Brett, you're on the line here on Skype. Hello, Brett.
Yo, hey. I just wanted to talk about this Ross, you know, Ulbricht.
Please.
I have never been more sickened with our government than today, than what has happened today.
Why?
Silk Road was a bastion for freedom, and
that's why they did what they did, right? I mean, that's why they went after Ross Ulbricht with the maximum force.
Well, of course, and I agree with what you said earlier that, you know, I've been in the same situation as you. Some bold drugs, I guess, and, you know, I've had some very bad trips, and I'm not trying to incriminate myself here, but I've gotten some stuff from Silk Road, and they were the, you know, purest. Everything was good. So it was, honestly the very safest method of getting, you know, what you're trying to get. And, it's just very sad.
You sound like you're having trouble putting sentences together. You're so upset about this.
Let me ask this question real quick. I understand being upset about it. But can you honestly say that you are surprised?
No, I'm not. Of course I'm not surprised. But I'm upset that this war on drugs is still going on. And it's funny to me because the Silk Road got taken down and three more popped up. And then, you know, the other three or whatever got taken down. And then 20 more popped up. You know, it's like they're not going to stop this. This is, I don't know. Yeah, right, I mean, you're right. I can't put.
We've heard you out. Thanks, Brett. Appreciate the call. Toll free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. I get it, man. It's frustrating.
It is really upsetting compared to the really unfair trial I went through. It was just, what? Well,
yeah, and the story.
Unfair is a vast understatement.
I agree.
It was a kangaroo court, and that's probably offensive to actual kangaroo courts.
Poor kangaroos.
I can definitely understand where Brett is coming from. It's hard to find words to express the frustration that, you know, a lot of us feel over the war on drugs, the total lack of compassion.
I came up with some words earlier. None of them can be repeated on the radio.
Yeah. When was this? When you heard the verdict or something?
When I saw it.
Yeah.
But again, I wasn't surprised.
You knew, right. And like I said, it's sad, but it's not a surprise.
I would have been surprised if he got less than 30 years.
So our toll-free number tonight is 855-450-FREE. We're going to come back. We'll continue with more of your calls and thoughts here. Ross Ulbricht sentenced to life in prison. No possibility for parole. Now, there is still a possibility they could appeal. Don't get your hopes up, though, that that's going to change anything. We can talk about that, what's going to come in the future here for Ross Ulbricht. But for the immediate future, it's going to be federal prison, and we don't yet know which one. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number.
Ooh, get the stinky dog away from me.
Petey stopped eating. All his hair fell out.
Mounds and mounds of fur.
Our hairballs have hairballs.
Bad breath and bad gas.
Chew himself raw. Sticky, gooey, smelly.
She scratched incessantly.
At least $5,000 in vet bills.
And all it took was one container of Dinovite.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
The omega-3 fatty acids.
Flaxseed, zinc, alfalfa.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
Adding Dinovite to their diet has every single dog in my kennel looking better than they have ever looked.
The shedding has stopped and the itching has stopped.
Tons of energy, no more bad smell.
She has gotten this puppy look. Her coat has sheen.
Everything we tried failed except the Dinovite.
My vet was completely blown away.
Dinovite's the bomb.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
On the average, Americans work between 45 to 50 years, hoping to build up enough wealth to retire and live out their golden years. Unfortunately, with taxation, the rising cost of food, energy, housing, and medical, many retirees are forced to live below the poverty line. Is this a flaw of free enterprise, or is our monetary unit we call the Federal Reserve Note forcing us into perpetual debt, ensuring inflation and higher taxes? These questions and more can be answered by reading G. Edward Griffin's book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. Congressman Ron Paul states, "It's what every American needs to know about central bank power. A gripping adventure into the secret world of international banking cartel." Hi, this is Ted Anderson. I will give a silver dollar from the early 1900s to anyone who purchases this book. Call 1-800-686-2237 and order a copy today. It's critical that the public be made aware of the system. Call and order your copy today at 1-800-686-2237. That's 1-800-686-2237.
Hi, I'm Derek J. I don't want a politician to represent me. To me, government is the idea that one group of people can coerce everyone to comply with an edict or face increasing punishments up to and including death. Despite perhaps the most noble of intentions, the best government services are a far cry from what could be provided for by voluntary interactions. Besides, the people who call themselves the government wage wars and put peaceful people in jail for crimes involving no victims. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
When I found the Free State Project, I knew it was the key to achieving liberty in my lifetime. It's awesome to be surrounded by like-minded, freedom-loving activists who've moved here to New Hampshire. From politics to civil disobedience, we have it all. Where I came from, it felt that no matter what I did, liberty was dying. Perhaps you feel the same way? Call 888-377-2515 now to learn more about the Free State Project. That's 888-377-2515 or visit freestateproject.org.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. Share your thoughts after the what seemed like an inevitable life verdict, life in prison with no parole for
and
Ross Ulbricht.
That's actually just the beginning. It gets worse.
It does?
Yes.
Okay, you're going to tell me about that. But
talk
first,
about that.
Have you or someone that you know been a victim of electronic pickpocketing? If not, you might be wondering what that is. Well, thieves can pass near you with a scanner and read the data on the RFID chips that may exist in your credit and debit cards. Those thieves can then use that information to charge your credit cards for their purchases, or worse yet, compromise your identity. Now, thanks to ID Stronghold, there's an easy way to prevent electronic pickpocketing from happening to you or your loved ones. ID Stronghold has been making products to block electronic pickpocketing since 2005, and some of their most loyal customers are military personnel that place a high value on personal security. Now you can also have that same protection in the form of great leather RFID blocking wallets made by ID Stronghold. That's right. All you need to do is switch your wallet for a quality leather wallet from ID Stronghold with built-in protection against electronic pickpocketing. Visit idstronghold.com and you can see their huge selection of his and hers wallets. That's idstronghold.com and tell them Ian Freeman sent you. idstronghold.com. As we continue here, Darryl, before I get back onto the phone calls here, what do you mean when you say it gets worse?
It gets much worse.
How could it be worse than life in
prison? Are you talking about all that money?
In addition, and this from the Wired article that you mentioned, in addition to his prison sentence, Ulbricht was ordered to pay restitution of more than $183 million.
Well, I'm sure he's going to get right on that.
All of the money that was seized from him will be credited towards that amount.
Right, which isn't even near that amount, right? Wasn't it only like $80 million worth of Bitcoin or something?
I think it was like 18.
Yeah, okay. So, all right, so what's he going to do about the rest of the $100 million plus? Nothing.
Well, right. My guess is the feds are going to come after his family for that.
How could they be responsible for
his
actions?
I really hope not. Yeah, they can't be responsible for his actions.
I don't. I'm just speculating, but the feds want their money, and they're going to get it however
his
they can get it.
His family doesn't have any money. They gave it all basically up to...
and they needed more for all that fundraising.
Right.
They couldn't pay for all that themselves.
Right. They essentially... I think they got like a second mortgage on their house or something crazy like that. I mean, these people have no money. So they're not going to get blood from a stone in this case. And I don't understand.
They'll sure as hell try.
Well, maybe they will. But I don't. I mean, I guess if that happens, Darryl, I definitely want to know about it because I'd be shocked that somebody can. I mean, I understand they hold parents responsible for not sending their kids to school. But that's when they're under the age of 18 and ostensibly are their wards. And so they're supposed to have this obligation to get them to school. But once you turn 18, then generally you don't see parents getting charged for the actions of their kids. I mean, did Jeffrey Dahmer's parents have to go and pay a bunch of money?
But the parents are accepting donations for the Legal Defense Fund. And my guess is the feds will try to confiscate everything from the defense fund before they pay the attorneys.
Oh, my God.
Again,
you think?
Purely speculation.
Does that ever happen? I mean, look, is it speculation based on you ever hearing of anything like that in the past?
No, it's speculation based on I know they want their money and they'll take what they can get.
So take that, with a grain of salt, listeners, it's total speculation based on just total speculation. Okay,
yes.
Got it. Let's go to your calls and thoughts here. We've got, I believe we got Stephen on the line via Skype, which at the moment is not responding. So stand by, Stephen. We'll get you on here in a moment. Stephen is with us, and he's in Texas. Skype, by the way, our username here is lrn.fm. Go ahead, Stephen.
Hey, been listening to your show for a couple of months. I do have a couple questions, thanks, about your content. So you guys often refer, or it seems to me you guys refer to the government as the state. And I'm wondering, what is the distinction there? Like, why would someone say the state versus the government?
So when I use the term the state, I am using it as like a proper noun where both letters are capitalized. So if I'm writing it out, it would be capital T, capital S. And the state is an entity that claims a monopoly on the use of force in a given area. So, for instance, you're in Texas, so the government of the state of Texas would be the state in Texas, and they claim a monopoly on the use of force. So if you do something that they have written in a book that says you can't do, so you're driving and you're not wearing a seatbelt, they will use force to either get you to comply or get money from you.
I mean, are you using it as a synonym for government?
In some ways.
Mm-hmm. Typically, I'll say state when I'm referring to an actual state's law, then the government for the federal government.
But I can use the state when I'm talking about the feds, the state itself, or the local government, because to me it's all a concept.
Right. It can be all
the government.
Same.
Is the state.
So what do you think about that, Stephen? Go ahead.
Yeah. It's a bit confusing, just I suppose, for someone not totally familiar with the ideas of liberty. But is there an example, like, can you have an example of a state that doesn't have a government, or does the term then don't apply?
I wouldn't
think. There have been stateless societies throughout history.
But that wouldn't be called a state then, right?
It would not be called a state. Right.
So no, I think the answer is no. You cannot have the state without people calling themselves government at the same time.
Okay.
And right, so, but you can't have a group of people living somewhere without a government.
Sure.
Okay.
Which would have nothing to do with the state.
So if you guys, and this is just my general sense from you guys from listening to your show, if you guys are against the state, does that mean that you're an anarchist?
I'm not an anarchist because I think the word anarchist says, you know, essentially means no rulers. And I like the idea of self-rule. So I think that you should govern yourself and rule yourself. So that would not make me an anarchist. What about you, Danica?
I wouldn't consider myself really an anarchist. I'd consider myself more of a voluntarist, whereas everything I feel should be done on a voluntary or
consensual basis. I like voluntarists too. That's a good word.
It's just like, you know, a bunch of people volunteering together to, hey, let's pave a better road so that everybody can enjoy it. We'll all each volunteer equal amounts of time and labor to get this done.
That's one way it could be done. But consensual road could be built by a company
state or something. Like, yeah. If I want to put all my money into a company that can pot themselves, sure.
Are you an anarchist?
People have used the term to describe me. If push came to shove, I would say I am an anti-archist, meaning that I am opposed to the idea of rulers that rule through coercion.
Okay.
I do use the term voluntarist at times. I also use the term libertarian, and I see the word libertarian as encompassing all of those anarchist, voluntarist, libertarian, and not the Glenn Beck, Sarah Palin type libertarians that aren't really libertarians, like,
so you're
actual
a lowercase
libertarian.
L, not an uppercase L.
Well, neither one of them are uppercase L's. I am a life member of the Libertarian Party.
An uppercase L means that you are a member of the Libertarian Party.
Yes.
A lowercase L means that you are just a libertarian.
Right. You ascribe to the libertarian ideology.
Stephen, does that help you at all?
Yeah. So generally, if you're against the state, then you just want to have some kind of either self-rule or voluntary association with the government.
Yeah, I would say that would be fairly accurate. Thank you for the call tonight. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, and you can join us just like Stephen did there via Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. There's a lot more to say about Ross Ulbricht. What's coming up next for him? I mean, now he's got life in prison. And we don't yet know which prison. We got details, 855-450-FREE, and want to hear your thoughts and feelings on this. It's Free Talk Live.
Are you suffering from EP? The symptoms include fraudulent charges to your credit card. Your Subway card says it's empty, but you bought it yesterday. Someone's been in your hotel room, but the desk clerk says they only show you entering the room. These are signs of EP, electronic pickpocketing. Payment cards, transit cards, even hotel room keys use a radio chip, so you can just wave your card at the register, the turnstile, or your hotel room door. But what's convenient for you is also convenient for thieves, waving scanners to electronically pickpocket you without even touching you. The good news is there's a cure. ID Stronghold has created leather wallets and clutches that have built-in EP protection, layers of shielding material cleverly concealed in a beautiful leather wallet that stops the symptoms of EP. Go to IDStronghold.com now and get the cure. IDStronghold.com. Warning, ID Stronghold wallets could lead to feelings of safety and security, comfort in crowds, and euphoria. If you experience these emotions, immediately inform your friends and family about IDStronghold.com so they can feel better too.
This is a national health care alert from the Health Hotline. If you, a family member, or a loved one suffers from knee pain and have Medicare as your primary insurance, we've got great news. You could qualify for a pain-relieving knee brace at little or no cost to you. Get free delivery, and all the paperwork is handled by our accredited suppliers at no charge to you. So if you're on Medicare and have knee pain, don't wait. You may qualify to immediately receive a pain-relieving knee brace at little or no cost. Friendly agents are standing by 24/7 to help you. We also have other pain-relieving braces, too, for your shoulder, ankle, or back. You may be eligible to get these items and more at little or no out-of-pocket cost. Our friendly representatives are standing by now to help you, so please call now. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Lil Drums. Every bit as fun as a full-size Nestle drumstick cone and definitely cuter. Visit us at drumstick.com. Vacations are all about family time, but you don't have to leave home to have fun. Take one weekend a month and devote it to family activities. Pull out the board games and puzzles, serve up some treats, or have a picnic. Even without leaving home, you'll feel like you've really had some time away. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
You may join us here on the radio waves. We can talk about Ross Ulbricht and him being sentenced to life in prison for running a website. That's really what we're talking about here. We're not talking about a drug kingpin who was murdering people. That's what the federal government would like you to believe about Ross Ulbricht. But the people who were alleging that he was committing murders, as in hiring people, hiring hitmen to kill competitors and things like that, kill people that had ostensibly were threatening to reveal information about his site, to be more specific. But, you know, in that situation, there's no real evidence for that beyond just some logs that were ostensibly found on his computer, which of course could have been planted there by the DEA agent who had skimmed some Bitcoin off of the top of the entire situation when they'd confiscated Ross's Bitcoin. Also, a Secret Service agent was illegally on the take as well. So he ended up finding out that these agents were very, very dishonest in this case.
The judge would not allow the defense to bring any of that up during the initial trial because of an ongoing investigation.
Exactly. And that was one of the myriad of things that this judge was suppressing at the trial to essentially prevent Ross from actually being able to present his case. But you actually, before we go on with the calls here tonight, Darryl, you were doing a little digging on Google or wherever, and you found some federal guidelines.
It's not necessarily federal guidelines. There's a website called prisontalk.com,
okay,
and they have forums. And one of the forum topics is about federal restitution. And
you know, these guys, a lot of guys who spend time in prison know the system, right? Like, they know what the limits are and the restrictions are. So I take this as good word.
Right. And the person that makes this post, he, you know, apparently the people know who he is. He says, as you know, I do this, that, and the other thing. And so he talks about some of the restitution stuff. And apparently I was incorrect in part of my speculation, maybe.
Okay.
If Ross's parents own anything that is in their name plus Ross's, that can be seized.
It can be. Okay. Right.
Yes. If Ross's name is on anything, that can be seized.
Got it.
But if it is not in Ross's name and it's just owned by a family member, it cannot be.
Okay, good.
So that's their house can't be taken as long as Ross is not on the
right
mortgage.
Okay. So the legal fund, if Ross's name is somehow tied as an owner of the fund, then the feds could probably seize that. There's also information about the commissary funds that inmates have. Right, so anything over... And this was written back in 2004, so the limit might be higher now than what it was then.
Or lower.
But at the time this was written, the limit was $290 per month that could be put onto a commissary fund that would not be able to be seized towards the restitution. So, for instance, this guy talks about he was ordered to pay $6 million in restitution, and he was allowed $290 per month in his commissary. Anything over that was liable to be seized and credited toward or debited towards his restitution that he owed.
So don't give a big donation to Ross Ulbricht's commissary, or else it'll just go and flush down the federal drain.
Right.
All right. Well, thank you for looking that up, Darryl. I appreciate the clarification. Let's go to Mr. Met. He's on the line in Florida. Mr. Met, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Danica, and Darryl.
Yeah, and I'm so sick of this pity party I'm reading about on Twitter and hearing on the radio. This guy, he knew all the risks that he was taking when he was a criminal. He was a drug dealer.
Well, that's not a bad thing.
Well, maybe not to you, but the rest of the civilized world.
Have you ever bought alcohol?
Yes, I believe alcohol is legal.
It doesn't matter. You're buying from a drug dealer.
Alcohol was illegal.
Yeah, why isn't the person who sold you alcohol a criminal in your mind?
Listen, I called to talk about this case. You're trying to sidetrack me. You don't want.
That's because you're a hypocrite.
Excuse me. You don't want to deal with the facts of the case. He was on trial. He was convicted. 3 hours, the jury listened to all the testimony. They went to deliberate for 3 hours, found him guilty. He was guilty of money laundering, selling drugs, hiding behind his little keyboard, and also threatening to kill people.
No, that was not one of the charges in the trial. I'm sorry, you're incorrect about that. He has not been indicted, from my understanding, with the murder charges at this point. That was just a way that they painted him with a real negative brush to try to make him look bad in front of the jury. This man should have been given an award for the life's work that he has put out into the world that has made the world a better place. It has made the world a safer place. and it has helped people.
Hey, listen, Ian, his mother has rejected your help. He has read in his letter that you read yesterday, he said he wishes he would have went down a different path. He was totally wrong.
Anybody will say anything when they're facing life in prison.
Excuse me, that's not the case. There are principled people like Mr. Chris Cantwell who will stand by the words he uses and stand by the actions he takes. He doesn't go and bow when there's a first sign of danger. Okay, if this guy thought he was innocent, he should have stood up and said what he did was right and he doesn't feel he did anything wrong. This guy.
Well, I would have loved to have had him say that, but he didn't do that, and you can't blame somebody for that. You know, even Chris Cantwell might apologize to a judge if he was facing life in prison as well, and I suspect you might too. Thanks, Mr. Met, for your call tonight. 855-450-FREE.
And also, it should be noted that Chris has had numerous interactions with police officers where he did not shoot them.
Yep, that's true.
That is right.
He's actually had conversations with police officers as though they were human beings, amazingly enough.
And I know at least five people that have taken one of his paper clips and never got killed.
What did you say, Danica?
Didn't he actually also in the videos say thank you to the police officer for being
there?
Yeah. And yeah, so he's actually thanked them too.
Courteous towards them and really was surprised with how courteous they've been towards him in certain incidents as well. So Chris Cantwell is a human being just like everybody else, and when human beings are put under an extreme amount of pressure, there's a good chance they're going to crack, and they're going to do things that they otherwise would like to believe that they wouldn't do. And while I share, like James Babb, for instance, made a great post on Facebook. I'm going to see if I can pull it up, but we've had James on the show. He's a Philly area activist, where he points out, and I think correctly so, fawning lawyers kissing judge butt accomplished nothing. All that money would have been better spent on a jailbreak. Now, obviously a jailbreak isn't likely going to, you know, be very successful, and I don't think he was serious about that, but I think what he's saying is that this was essentially throwing a bunch of money down a hole if Ross wasn't going to stand on principle. Here's what he follows it up with, saying, of course, hindsight's 20/20, but did anyone expect a different outcome? What if from day one, Ross had proudly taken ownership of his accomplishments? What if he had spent the last few years making a moral case for free markets? What if the judge had been treated as the enemy that she is? What could possibly have gone worse? We always lose on their battlefield, but we have a chance of winning when we appeal directly to the public, which, of course, is what didn't happen as of 2 days into the trial. Our friends, Derek J. Freeman and some of the other activists from the Keene area.
James and Jay.
Right. They went down, the proprietors of 101 Deals, they went down, they had signs. There were several people, including a couple folks came out from Manchester as well. They all carpooled down. There were some of the folks from Philly, James Babb was there, and others came out to do some jury nullification outreach to the jurors. They came out to hold signs informing the potential jurors about what the sentence might be for Ross, because that's one of the things they'll never tell a jury in court, is what the possible sentence is that the person is facing. And so they tried to get information to these people. They tried to run some level of a PR campaign towards these jurors, and they were shut down by virtue of the fact that the judge threatened the jury with sequestering, and essentially that pressured Ross and his mother into asking the activists to go home. And that, I think, changed the direction of where things could have gone for the trial into just basically begging for the state's mercy. 855-450-FREE, and that didn't work. More coming up here on Free Talk Live.
In a trial by jury, the primary function of a juror is not to dispense punishment to the accused. It is to protect your fellow citizens from being unjustly deprived of their life, liberty, or property. As a juror, you can say no to unjust laws and prevent government abuses of power by refusing to convict. Legislative, executive, judicial. The fourth branch of government is we the people. Find out more from the Fully Informed Jury Association at fija.org.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
Did you know that drinking pure, high-alkaline water is one of the most important factors in maintaining high energy and vibrant health? Most experts agree that the water you drink should be at a pH level of 8 or higher. AlkaVision Plasma pH Drops, available only at AlkaVision.com, combine a unique formula of only the most alkaline minerals. AlkaVision Plasma pH Drops alkalize your water, ridding the body of harmful toxins, and helps you regain health and energy. Alkalizing your water by simply adding 10 drops of AlkaVision Plasma pH Drops helps the body rid itself of acidic waste, increases oxygen content, and raises the pH of your body to healthy levels. And bacteria and viruses cannot survive in an alkaline high pH environment. Order your bottle of AlkaVision Plasma pH Drops for only $29.95 at AlkaVision.com. That's A-L-K-A-Vision.com. Or call 269-409-1776. 269-409-1776. Alkalize your body. Supercharge your health at AlkaVision.com today.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project, and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolf. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, you can join us on the radio waves here toll free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Life in prison for Ross Ulbricht. He is the man who I think is a hero for doing what he did, for creating the Silk Road, which has been a real benefit to humanity. Joining you in the studio tonight, by the way, it's Ian.
Danica.
And Darryl.
Don't forget to check out Darryl's website, fpp.cc. I imagine you've reposted this news there already?
Not yet.
Okay.
Although it's interesting that you went ahead and mentioned the website, because I'm having the anniversary sale this weekend.
Of fpp.cc.
Of FPP. So all of the books that you can purchase with Bitcoin directly from the Bitcoin store, you can now send 10% of your purchase to the Free Ross Legal Defense Fund coupon code Ross.
So coupon code Ross over at fpp.cc. Books are available there of a variety of different types.
Right, and 15% discount over the weekend.
So we don't yet know, by the way, where Ross is going to end up in prison. That remains to be seen. As soon as we find that out, we'll give you that information. He is sentenced to life with no possibility of parole. And I want to continue with your calls and thoughts here. Let's go to Troy, listening in Minnesota to WNMT. Hey, Troy.
Hey, guys. How you doing tonight?
Good. Go ahead, sir.
Hey. Well, you guys know how I feel about smoking, you know, weed anyway. But bottom line is, the sentence that this old boy got, that's way out of line. You should have got 6 months. I mean, really? I mean,
oh, that'd be nice.
Life in prison.
Well, they wouldn't have been able to give him 6 months because he's already spent a year and a half in there. So even if there was no mandatory minimum,
let him go.
Yeah, it would have been time served. But boy, that would be a wonderful world if we lived in that one.
Why?
Unfortunately,
I mean, does the judge got any type of explanation why?
No, and apparently she also doesn't have a heart or any kind of shred of humanity left inside of her. Because this woman went over and above even what the prosecutors were recommending.
Because the prosecutors wanted 30 years or 35?
They didn't give a specific number. The prosecutors said they wanted significantly more than the minimum, which was 20.
20, yeah.
So that could have meant anything. And the judge, you know, again, it's just a recommendation. The judge can do whatever she darn well pleases. And it's pretty clear. It's pretty clear to me that she's had it in for Ross since day number one of this entire situation coming to her courtroom.
But still, I mean, when you think about all the stuff that goes on out there with these major drug dealers and everything, they don't get life in prison, you know?
Yeah, well, they want to send a message. You know, that's part of what's going on here is that Ross Ulbricht is the first person to go down for operating one of these underground drug marketplaces. And so basically they want to give him a real good spanking so as to show the other people out there who are running the other dozen plus 20, whatever, how many of them there are now, underground drug marketplaces on the internet to try to scare them out of doing what they're doing. And of course, they won't be dissuaded because, well, you know, there are always people who are willing to take the risk of operating within the black market because there are great rewards in that are concomitant with those risks.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, I don't know what a person can do at this point in time, you know, throw a bunch of money at it. But,
that doesn't seem to have helped so far. I mean, I can't say I'm particularly pleased with the attorney in Ross's case, Joshua Dreidel. I still am supporting Ross just because, well, I want to support Ross, and this is the only way to do it. But I'm not happy with the idea that this guy walked into court during the opening statement and said, yeah, my client did it, but, you know, and then tried to tell some story that suggested that Ross wasn't involved for the entire time of the Silk Road, which may be the truth, but ultimately that was
the thing is,
never told.
It's just another overreach of our government. You know, I mean, overreach of the court systems, you know, and I'm not really into punishing, you know, these people like him. I mean, really, how much harm did he really do? You know?
I'm with you, Troy. Thanks for your call tonight, man. I appreciate you sharing your thoughts. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Yeah, 6 months have been great for this, but
time served would have been better.
Yeah. Now they're just going to steal whatever this brilliant man could have brought to the world. I mean, he could have brought so much else to the world that was wonderful, just like the Silk Road. And now he will be prohibited from doing anything for the world, except for maybe, you know, maybe he'll write from his cell. I mean, if we're lucky, that's what we'll get out of Ross. But that's about all you can do.
Yeah, it would be great if he wrote a book.
Or anything, series of articles or whatever. I mean, I'd be happy to publish them. I think that'd be fantastic. Tell the story at this point. You got nothing to lose. Unless, of course, she gets an appeal to a new trial, which I highly doubt is going to happen. Maybe he'll get an appeal, because he could appeal a couple different things, right? Like, as I understand it, and I'm not a lawyer, but he could appeal the verdict. You know, he could appeal certain points of law from the first trial, saying, oh, well, you know, these things were done incorrectly by the trial court.
Suppression of evidence.
Yeah, so there's that. And then there's also, he could try to appeal the judge's decision to grant him a new trial, because they did try to get that after after he was found guilty. They put in a motion for a retrial, basically. And the judge, of course, said, well, no, my trial, my courtroom's fine. Everything's fine here. Everything's just peachy. Let's not do anything like that,
yeah,
because
I
would
don't
be admitting I have problems.
I don't know of any judge that will grant a motion to reconsider
his own
opinion.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, you know what? You made a really good point. I did goof up.
Yeah, exactly. So, well, I mean, but that's what you would appeal, right? You would appeal the judge's decision to not allow the retrial. So I guess there's a couple different ways they can come at this. And you're welcome to share your thoughts. Maybe you are an attorney and you've studied the case in a detailed manner. We'd love to hear from you. 855-450-FREE. Let's go to Jesse in Lake Isabella. Jesse, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Danica, and Darryl.
Hi, how are you doing?
Hey, go ahead, sir. Good.
Yeah, we're talking about bad cop versus good cop. We had an incident, me and my wife. We're going through a foreclosure process. We're trying to save the home. The deputies come out and try to give us notice on levying the house. We go down to the courthouse, the Kern County Courthouse here, and we're discussing the paperwork. My wife gets intimidated by it. She's starting to tear up a little bit. And I tell her that if we're going to have to take care of it, we're going to have to take care of it here. Now, yeah, I did get into a loud voice with it because we were both pretty upset about the situation. Out of nowhere pops seven deputies. They're all in our face.
Oh.
They pull my wife away, sit her down in a corner, and sit her down, making her all nervous. They're telling me one guy's bulldogging me. Another four deputies are kind of like cooling down the situation. One's telling me if I don't get out, he's going to arrest me. And I said, if you arrest me, I'm going to go ahead and sue you for false arrest. Now, he's bulldogging me the whole time while these other deputies are trying to calm him down.
Hmm.
Two of the deputies look at him, and they're about ready to size him up and get him out the door. But picture this from a lady's perspective. My wife is in the corner, and she's tearing up, and they're intimidating the hell out of her.
Has she ever been treated like that before by police?
Never.
Okay. Yep, that's frustrating.
Makes you want to do
something as the man in the situation, which, of course, they would love to have you do, right? If they're intimidating your wife, you might lunge at one of those officers in your frustration and anger.
You might raise your voice, and then they would get you for, contempt of cop.
The sheriff here is really great. I've known him for a lot of years, and you know what? I don't know what's going on, but when they allow one guy to bounce around and make these threats and get in your face, and he was drawing me into a confrontation. He wanted me to hit him.
So he wasn't even the lead deputy, if there's such a thing? He was just a deputy just like the others?
Yeah, he wanted to be the lead deputy. He was just bouncing around back there, agitating the situation. And my wife's over here crying, bawling her eyes out.
That's awful.
And so when I finally make the complaint about this, the guy tells me, well, they're up on an adrenaline pump when they're at the courthouse because of the situation.
What situation is that?
He never did explain what situation. Did they think that you were threatening your wife
because you raised your voice?
That's what I came to the conclusion of. When we were driving home, they had her in there surrounded. This same jerk-off that was trying to agitate me kept telling her, and it kept irritating me. He kept telling her, you want me to drive you somewhere? And I kept thinking, and it made her nervous. Just picture yourself. You're a lady, and here's this one guy that's agitating your husband, and there's six other sheriff deputies there all around you and in your face, and this one guy's bouncing around telling, your wife, is there anywhere I can take you? That spooked the hell out of me.
Well, needless to say, you didn't feel protected and served in that incident, huh?
I was terrified. My wife was terrified. She was terrified. Now, I was terrified that this guy and all these guys around me in my face. One guy was right there, 3 inches away, telling me that, do you know who I am? I own this courthouse. This guy was out there telling me, yeah, this is his courthouse. He said, this is my courthouse. Yeah. This is a sheriff bailiff.
Did you? Now, what happens if you bring out a video camera inside the court facility?
You know what? They'd probably boot my ass out.
Yeah, well, they would do the same thing here, unfortunately. We can get cameras into the courtroom, no problem. They start to get real antsy when you pull a camera out in the courthouse around here, and they've arrested multiple activists for it. Thanks for sharing your story, Jesse. I can totally empathize with it, having spent plenty of time in courts. In fact, I was in one today, as a matter of fact. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. So was Ross Ulbricht. We've got more to say about his situation where he's now going to stay in prison for the rest of his life. It's Free Talk Live. We're running a website, by the way. That's all he did. It's Free Talk Live. Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com.
Starring toothpaste is loaded.
watching the game again. I thought you were booking our vacation hotel.
Done.
What?
We're staying in America's Best Value Inn, and I scored a triple play when I joined their free value club.
Really?
You get 15% off, a room upgrade, and late checkout when available. Plus free Wi-Fi and continental breakfast at most of their 1,000 hotels.
Wow, that really is a slam dunk.
Home run, honey. I think you mean home run.
Score big this summer at America's Best Value Inn at ABVI.com.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate.
Oof, I think we've all had enough of that jingle, don't you? If you're going to invest in property in New Hampshire, it just makes sense to support a liberty-friendly realtor. Call Mark Warden of Team Porcupine Real Estate for investment property or rentals in the free state, or visit his website. Come on, you know it.
PorcupineRealEstate.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Darryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 29th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.71 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,188 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $238. Antiwar.com reports the northern Syrian city of Arhiha, the last government-held city of the Idlib province, fell yesterday to Al-Qaeda's Nusra Front and its allies, giving them effective control over the entire province. The attack on the city near the Turkish border began earlier in the day with the fall of military checkpoints around the city. Syrian state media reported heavy fighting inside the city. Later, the Syrian government confirmed that the city fell outright, saying the military had moved to defensive positions outside the city after an influx of a large number of Nusra fighters. Pre-war, the city had about 80,000 people, and it lies along a key supply route between Idlib and the coastal Latakia province. Nusra has already made some attempts at Latakia as well, and this will likely make such an offensive easier.
For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
UPI reports protesters gathered at six interior border checkpoints in Arizona on Wednesday, where residents argue Border Patrol officials have turned their hometowns into militarized zones. At the Aravica checkpoint, about 35 miles south of Tucson, up to 20 Border Patrol agents were stationed to await the estimated 75 protesters who demand the removal of the checkpoints. Some checkpoints are up to 100 miles away from the border. Patty Miller, an area resident for over 30 years, said through Megaphone, "It seems like a war zone all the time." The organized protest by independent border town community groups focused on issues ranging from the environmental effects of border fences to a checkpoint's intrusion on Native American tribal land. The Aravica checkpoint was established 8 years ago and is the smallest of 11 checkpoints in the Tucson sector. Another protester told the media, "This checkpoint serves as a deterrent to living in Aravica." Manuel Padilla, chief patrol agent of the Border Patrol in the Tucson sector, was at the Aravica checkpoint and said checkpoints like these help secure Arizona and monitor illegal immigration. He added, "It's legal to run the checkpoints. If someone has a disagreement with the law, there are channels to express that."
You can support FPP Radio by shopping online. Whether you're looking for precious metals, bitcoins, or books, you'll find that and more at shop.fppradio.com. Or you can shop directly from FPP with Bitcoin in the Bitcoin store. Every purchase you make from one of my affiliates at shop.fppradio.com helps fund FPP Radio. Reuters reports former Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives Dennis Hastert was indicted on Thursday on federal charges, including for lying to the FBI relating to an alleged effort to hide $3.5 million in payments he was making to a person to conceal past misconduct. The U.S. Attorney's Office in Chicago said the Illinois Republican, who left Congress in 2007, was charged with structuring the withdrawal of $952,000 in cash to evade the requirements that bank report transactions over $10,000 and lying to the FBI about the withdrawals. Each count of the two-count indictment carries a maximum penalty of 5 years in prison and a $250,000 fine. Hastert resigned on Thursday from the Dickstein Shapiro law firm in Washington, where he was listed as a senior advisor, and from the board of the exchange operator CME Group Incorporated, according to representatives of both the law firm and CME. Hastert could not be reached immediately to comment on the indictment. According to the indictment, the unspecified misconduct involved payments to an unnamed individual who had been a Yorkville, Illinois resident and had known Hastert for most of the person's life. According to the indictment, Hastert met with the person several times around 2010 and discussed past misconduct by the former lawmaker. Eventually, Hastert agreed to pay the person $3.5 million in compensation to conceal the misconduct. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
We're being attacked by news from all sides in tonight's News Blitz. Now we're homing in on Houston, Texas, where NASA announced today that the crew of the International Space Station has successfully completed their 13-year mission studying man's ability to constantly repair a large object in space. NASA officials hailed the remarkable feat of maintenance at a press conference this afternoon.
And throughout human history, man has gazed at the stars and dreamed of fixing something up there. People once thought the ultimate feat in human repair was a really big boat. Today, we've accomplished so much more.
This comes in the wake of NASA's previous success, finding out how many times an astronaut could hold something in his hand, then let it go, watch it float in front of his face for a bit, then catch it again. All right, dust yourself off. You have survived the News Blitz.
Tune in tomorrow morning to Today Now. We'll look back at Jim's week as a polygamist.
Oh, it's going to be fun.
This is the Onion News Network.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. Plenty of time for you to join us here and talk about whatever's on your mind. You don't have to just talk about Silk Road, or certainly, although certainly we will be talking more about Ross Ulbricht and his life sentence now in federal prison with no possibility of parole, plus over $180 million in fines.
$183 million in restitution.
So-called restitution. It's only restitution, but it actually goes to victims. And of course, Ross Ulbricht has no victims.
Well, the state is the victim.
No, no, they're not. But they would like you to believe that their peace and dignity has been disturbed. That's what they always say in their little complaints.
Congress disturbs the peace and dignity of the state. No, that's
they have
the real...
no peace and dignity. The state's a violent organization from top to bottom.
Right. And the reason that I said, you know, the state is the victim is because that's really the only crime is disobeying the state.
Yeah, that's why he got sentenced to life in prison, whereas a murderer or a rapist would not be sentenced as harshly. Ross Ulbricht stuck it in the face of the state by creating the Silk Road and essentially undermining, you know, a lot of the work that the government agents have tried to do to stop drugs, which of course has been completely futile. But the Silk Road made it even easier to ship drugs around the world. It made it even easier for drug buyers to hook up with legitimate drug sellers who are actually marketing product that they claimed they were marketing, rather than, you know, questionable street dealers who are sometimes selling things that they're not claiming they're selling. The actual product in the pill is not what is being advertised, and that can put people in danger and can hurt them and possibly even kill them. So Ross Ulbricht, by creating the Silk Road, helped make people safer in the black marketplace. And the black marketplace doesn't have to exist, but it does because of the state. The state benefits from the black marketplace. They benefit in the form of, you know, more funding for their various different state agencies like the police. And Ross Ulbricht really kind of put a kink in their game. I mean, it had always been the same game for the state for the longest time, right? Like, oh, well, let's find some drugs. We'll interdict. You know, we'll get them at the border. We'll get them with the Coast Guard. And we'll bust the growers and the manufacturers within the U.S. And
or
now,
we'll bring the drugs in ourselves from the CIA, and then we bust the people that we sell them to.
Right. All of that's, you know, the classic drug war. But then this whole internet version of the war on drugs has completely changed the game. And it's changed it for the better, and it's not going anywhere. There are now dozens of sites that are like the Silk Road. So like, you know, the Hydra, you cut off one head and two more take its place. In the case of the Silk Road, several more took its place. And Agora, the most popular black market site in the world as of the last few weeks, at least the last time I checked,
I looked earlier today, and that
still
is
number one.
That's still number one.
They are they have been there since the end of the Silk Road, so they've been around for almost 2 years now on Agora, and I'm sure that really makes the feds upset because the Silk Road made it for like two and a half years or something like that, three maybe. I don't know what the exact time frame was. I think it was like 2.5. And so Agora is going to, at some point, if they continue with their status, last longer than the Silk Road. That's certainly possible. They've not been taken down yet. Now, they have a lot of downtime, but that's probably because their site is constantly being hacked or attempted to be hacked or DDoSed, denial of service attacked, and things like that.
Now, I know you said that Silk Road 3 had been on, but has it been taken down? Or
no,
has
it's
it,
still there.
It's still there, okay.
It's just not one of the big players
it's
anymore.
It's not one of the big players anymore.
I think people are burned out on the Silk Road brand at this point. You know, the second Silk Road went down after it had only been up for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And they had feds that were working with the developers from the get-go on Silk Road 2.
That's right, because a federal agent had worked his way into the administrative role of Silk Road 1. When Silk Road 2 launched, that same federal agent was there in the beginning of Silk Road 2. So even before Silk Road 2 had opened its doors, it was compromised by a federal agent on the administrative level. So that, I think, that level of, oh, crap, look what happened here. There's, you know,
three
this,
times a charm, right?
Right, this high-level infiltration going on here. Who really trusts the Silk Road? Just because somebody puts up the picture of the camel.
Yeah, the name has been kind of tarnished now.
Well, and that, but plus, you know, the you don't know who you're dealing with, right?
That's
I mean,
true.
These are black markets. They're anonymously run. There's no way to verify that this isn't a federal honeypot or whatever. All that considered, there was a lot of business done on Silk Road 2.0, and you know, we haven't seen thousands of arrests from all of the various different dealers and those people on there. Douglas is with us in Manchester. We'll talk more about Ross Ulbricht's sentencing here in a little bit. Douglas, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Danica, and Darryl. Douglas in Manchester.
Yes.
Going once. Hey there.
Yes, sir. Sorry about that.
No worries. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering if you guys saw the video of, it was recently online on Lively. There was a young black dude in a motel parking lot, private property, and he was finishing his supper or something, and the police officer started harassing him, and he did it perfectly. He just told him the facts, didn't tell him what room number he was in, didn't have to identify himself because he was not breaking the law. And this is the way it should be done every time.
Where does one, what does one look for in order to find this particular video?
It was in Virginia.
You don't have the title in front of you?
It was on LiveLeak.
LiveLeak.org,
I believe.
Tell you what, if you figure out what the link was, then I would recommend posting it on our freetalklive.com website. You can go there, and with our Reddit-based system, you can submit content right there to the front page. So when you find that link, just submit it there, and then other listeners can vote it up or down, whether they like or dislike. But you liked it, huh? You liked the fact that he stood up for himself and he didn't give any information to the cops. Sounds like it's a really good video.
Did he show his ID? Yeah, it was perfect.
And you're not obligated to. I mean, look, I'm not a lawyer or anything like that, but it's my understanding that if you're just on the street and the cops come up to you, you aren't obligated to talk to them at all.
It depends on the jurisdiction, because some states do have laws that say that you must identify.
But must identify is different than showing an ID, right? Like, because
this is different, though, because this is private property. This is a motel parking lot. You can tell him, hey, it's none of your business. Same thing as a grocery store parking lot. And you just tell him that's not your problem.
Well, what Darryl's saying is that some states do have a requirement that if an officer asks you for identification, that you do have to identify, which means you have to give them your name, typically, and a date of birth. Usually,
right, and they will tell you that, well, I can't verify that unless you show me a piece of plastic that we had given you that has that information on it.
That's a lie, because...
It is, yeah. But, mm-hmm. you know, like...
Because you're not obligated to carry a government
ID. Like Missouri, for instance, they do have a must-identify law. So if a police officer asks you to identify yourself, you must do so. You don't have to produce them government ID because there's no legal requirement to have government ID.
Correct. There's no legal requirement to have a driver's license or even just a government ID card either.
Right.
Hey, Douglas, thanks for your call. And again, if you find that link, throw it up there on freetalklive.com. Appreciate that. Toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. Stories from Wired.com's Andy Greenberg. Andy, as I mentioned in the last hour, has been following the Silk Road case since before there was a case. He was the first person to interview Dread Pirate Roberts back in the summer of 2013. And he was also the person who did, in my opinion, the most detailed, the best reporting from the courtroom during the several weeks of the Ross Ulbricht trial in Manhattan. So I'm going to share his report here from Wired, but there's also another really good one over at Vice.com, so those are probably two of the best. Ross Ulbricht conceived of his Silk Road black market as an online utopia beyond law enforcement's reach. Now he'll spend the rest of his life firmly in its grasp, locked inside a federal penitentiary. On Friday, that's today, Ulbricht was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole for his role in creating and running Silk Road's billion-dollar anonymous black market for drugs. Judge Catherine Forrest gave Ulbricht the most severe sentence possible, beyond what even the prosecution had explicitly requested. The minimum Ulbricht could have served was 20 years. She told Ulbricht as she read the sentence, quote, "The stated purpose of the Silk Road was to be beyond the law. In the world you created over time, democracy didn't exist. You were captain of the ship, the Dread Pirate Roberts," she told him, referring to his pseudonym as the Silk Road's leader. Going on to say, "Silk Road's birth and presence asserted that its creator was better than the laws of this country. This is deeply troubling, terribly misguided, and very dangerous." Let's pick that apart here in a few moments. We'll come back to it. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Yeah, it is dangerous, Judgy Poo, when people start questioning the state and doing what they want. It's Free Talk Live.
Warning. If you've recently declared bankruptcy, you're going to want to change the station. Because there's an alternative to bankruptcy, and it's faster than you'd ever think possible. But if you've already declared bankruptcy and have missed this opportunity, you'll want to change the station now. Here it is. Right now, the company that has resolved more credit card debt than anyone in the U.S. is available to settle your debt, too. You may reduce your debt with one low monthly program payment. If you call right now, Freedom Debt Relief will show you how low your monthly program payment could be for free. Call now. 1-800-399-1993. That's 1-800-399-1993. If you're struggling with debt, this could be your answer. And the bigger your debt, the more money you could save. To find out for free how much of your hard-earned money Freedom Debt Relief could help you save, call now. 1-800-399-1993. 1-800-399-1993. 1-800-399-1993.
Again, the Congressional Budget Office sounds the alarm. This time warns of Greek-style U.S. debt crises. You heard me right. The GAO is drawing a parallel between the U.S. economy, its debt, and the current Greek economic meltdown. With the debt-to-GDP chart climbing into unfamiliar territory, the growing budget deficit will rise to unsupportable levels. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. The Federal Debt and Risk of Financial Crises document the CBO has published is a must-read for every American. Covering the risk of continued deficit spending coupled with an aging population and the rising interest rates spell economic disaster. It's imperative that you get a copy of this document and study it for yourself. Call me today at 800-686-2237, and I'll send you a free copy. Again, call 800-686-2237 and ask for your copy of the CBO document. Once again, you need to read this government report. Call 800-686-2237.
Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenevention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenevention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenevention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenevention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenevention.info. Visit keenevention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenevention.info. Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments around the world killing innocent people? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin is money that cannot be inflated or controlled by any state. By continuing to use their money, you're perpetuating the killing. Stop doing it. You have an incredible alternative available to you now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. It's weusecoins.com.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You can join us here on the radio waves at 855-450-FREE. A hero is going to prison for life. A man named Ross Ulbricht has been convicted and sentenced now to life in prison for running a website. He created the Silk Road. It's an underground marketplace, or it was. It's now long since gone. It died in October of 2013 when the federal government raided the Silk Road. They took its server, they copied the information from that server, and they used that information to track down its owner, Ross Ulbricht.
And they used this wonderful thing called magic to find the server. And I say they used magic because the report that was written up by the FBI does not fit in line with this thing called physics or reality. Yeah, and the guy that wrote the report, surprisingly, did not testify during the trial.
Yeah, they suppressed a lot of the evidence that could have helped Ross out, and they never got to find out in the trial. Because a lot of us who have been following the trial had hoped that we would find out, at least learn the story of how they found the Silk Road server during the trial, but no.
Magic.
That was just not even discussed, and the evidence that was presented was just taken as legitimate when it all could have been planted. I mean, Every bit of it could have been planted. And that's, I know that sounds super paranoid, right? Like, oh, well, he admitted to being Dread Pirate Roberts. Okay, fine. So he did admit to being...
No, he admitted to having created the Silk Road. But his attorney said that he gave the site over to somebody else.
Not right away, though.
After a couple of months.
Right. So he was Dread Pirate Roberts for a couple of months, and then he gave it away to somebody else is what the story was. So he admitted to that in his opening statement. And I think that was a mistake. They should have made the state prove all of that. Instead, you know, he basically handed the state its own prosecution. You know, it was just... I had some real problems the way this thing was handled legally, and I wish it was different, but it's too late now. And apparently the same attorney is going to handle the appeal, so I can't say I'm particularly excited about the direction that could possibly go. And this is, of course, the same attorney who encouraged likely Ross to tell the activist to go home. The activist who had traveled, you know, miles upon miles, coming from as far away as other countries, I believe, to support Ross Ulbricht at his trial. Anyway, he was sentenced to life in prison. The story from Wired.com's Andy Greenberg. We'll continue with it here in a moment.
But just because Ross Ulbricht has gone to prison and the Silk Road has been shut down doesn't mean Bitcoin is doing bad. Bitcoin is doing much better than it was when it started. It was around less than a cent, and now it's over $230 per Bitcoin.
I forget what the exact first price was. It was something that I had pulled up a while back because I wanted to figure out.
It was less than a cent, though, wasn't it?
It was like 1,000 for a penny,
okay,
or something. Whoa. So it was way under a cent.
Right. The first purchase.
It was a lot of them.
The lowest I remember Bitcoin ever being was, I think, $25, $30 or something like that.
The first purchase was 10,000 Bitcoin for two large pizzas that was roughly $20.
Oh, my gosh.
So that's like 0.002 cents.
Right. When I first heard about Bitcoin, I think it was 12, maybe 13 cents.
ExpressCoin is where you can go to get Bitcoin as well as Litecoin and Dogecoin. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. They're a licensed money services business, and you can get your cryptocurrency with money order or check. Just get started over at ExpressCoin.com, and you can do it whether you're in the U.S. or Canada. Again, that's ExpressCoin.com. From your smartphone, you can download their app at ExpressCoin.com, and whether you use the app or just use the website, you can use coupon code FTL when you check out to get up to $40 worth of cryptocurrency with no fee at all. So go to ExpressCoin.com, and don't forget to use coupon code FTL. Judge Catherine Forrest sentenced Ross Ulbricht and made this statement. This is part of her statement. The stated purpose of the Silk Road was to be beyond the law. In the world you created over time, democracy didn't exist. Well, how dare you make a website that's not democratically run? I mean, what kind of a political statement is this?
I can't even, like, comprehend and put my head around what she's saying. Basically, she's throwing out all of these platitudes that sound good, like, America. She might as well have just sat up there and said,
America,
America, you die in jail. Because America.
Right.
Is that right?
Well, right. I mean, the suggestion here is that America is the preeminent thing, that the United States is what the model for all business should be. Right, you are not a democracy. My God, how dare you, sir?
And people conflate democracy with freedom.
No,
democracy is not freedom.
This woman represents democracy right here. The woman, the judge in this case, she's a part of democracy. Democracy is what did this in part to Ross Ulbricht.
People voted. We said you can't do this, so now you die.
Silk Road, she goes on, though. She says, Silk Road's birth and presence asserted that its creator was better than the laws of this country. Now, there's an ellipsis in there. The ellipsis is between its and creator. So I don't know what her full statement was. But she's attacking Ross here for the disobedience that you talked about before, Darryl, where you said that the great crime in America, the most punished crime in America, more so than murder, rape, any of the bad stuff put
together. I'd actually say anywhere in the world, the only real crime is disobeying the state.
Right. And that's what she's getting at here by saying that you thought you were better than the laws of this country. She says, this is deeply troubling. Terribly misguided and very dangerous. Well, that's because if the state loses its power and its legitimacy, then yeah, it's a very dangerous thing from their perspective.
This woman, and again, I'm speculating, but based on what I've seen and read of the way this woman runs her court, she would have thrown Martin Luther King in jail for years. She would have sentenced Gandhi to life in prison for disobeying. We have laws. Harriet Tubman would have gone to jail forever because of this woman.
In addition to his prison sentence, Ulbricht was ordered to pay a massive restitution of more than $183 million, with what the prosecution had estimated to be the total of the illegal drug sales and counterfeit IDs.
Estimated.
Right. through the Silk Road at a certain... Well, they are estimating based supposedly on the data they stole from the server. Through the Silk Road at a certain Bitcoin exchange rate over the course of its time online. Any revenue from the government sale of the Bitcoin seized from the Silk Road server and Ulbricht's laptop will be applied to that debt. Ulbricht had stood before the court just minutes earlier in navy blue prison clothes, pleading for a lenient sentence. He said, quote, I've changed. I'm not the man I was when I created the Silk Road. I'm a little wiser,
He said as his gross voice grew hoarse with emotion and cracked, a little more mature and much more humble. I wanted to empower people to make choices in their lives, to have privacy and anonymity, he told the judge. I'm not a sociopathic person trying to express some inner badness, unquote. Ulbricht's sentencing likely puts the final seal on the saga of Silk Road, the anarchic underground market the 31-year-old Texan created in early 2011. At its peak, the dark web site grew to a sprawling smorgasbord of every narcotic imaginable before Ulbricht was arrested in a public library in San Francisco in October of 2013. 18 months later, he was convicted in a Manhattan court on 7 felony charges, including conspiracies to traffic in narcotics and launder money, as well as a kingpin charge, usually reserved for the leaders of organized crime groups. We'll come back with more about the Silk Road conviction and sentencing here in moments.
For over 5 years, you've been hearing about the Berkey guy, so you may know a few things about him. For example, you are well aware of the superior quality and effectiveness of Berkey water filters and accessories. But did you know the Berkeys have had independent lab tests done to prove just how effective they are? It's true, and he can email you the test results. Just visit GoBerkey.com. You may also know that the Berkey guy has helped tens of thousands of people get better prepared. Now here's something you may not know. GoBerkey.com has amazing specials and deals all the time on a wide variety of survival and preparedness products. Most ready to ship same day. Visit the Berkey guy at GoBerkey.com and be sure to click the red Products on Sale Now button. You can always call toll-free 877-886-3653. Again, that's 877-886-3653. GoBerkey.com, home of the Berkey guy.
Cato University is the Cato Institute's premier educational event of the year. It's being held this year from July the 26th to the 31st at the Cato Institute's state-of-the-art headquarters in Washington, D.C. This annual program brings together outstanding faculty and participants from across the country and often from around the globe, with everyone sharing a commitment to liberty and learning. Cato University is a genuine community, and you can freely share viewpoints, concerns, ideas, questions, and more in an atmosphere of friendship and personal respect. It's a one-of-a-kind program for people who don't stop thinking after they got out of school. It's for people who don't want politicians or bureaucrats or officials to do their thinking for them. It's for people who value liberty. You'll learn, you'll be inspired, you'll make new friends, you'll meet great people from around the world. All of the details are spelled out at the Cato website, cato.org, and they hope to see you there this summer, July the 26th through the 31st in Washington, D.C. Again, details are at cato.org.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
It was on this day in 1982 that the first roller skating while carrying a boombox member of Congress was elected when James Sugar Boots Franklin narrowly won New York's 8th congressional seat. Franklin's victory was a watershed moment at the time, signaling that America's burgeoning population of boombox carrying roller skaters had finally gained mainstream acceptance.
We prove Congress isn't just for suits and crew cuts. Say hello to the slickest legislator on 8 wheels, James Sugar Boots Franklin.
Franklin was an unlikely pioneer, a street-smart skater who admitted to being more concerned with impressing honeys with his silky smooth moves than with politics.
Franklin began organizing boombox-carrying roller skaters, advocating for basic rights like roller skate-accessible ramps in government buildings and protected street lanes where they could lay down cones for some sweet slaloming.
Just because we like to roll it out and have a smooth, fluid style that cannot be denied doesn't mean we aren't Americans.
That's right.
This is the Onion News Network.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. Dial toll free. Share your thoughts on Ross Ulbricht. He's going to prison. He's already in prison. He's going to be staying there now for the rest of his life. Unless some sort of miracle happens and he's allowed to appeal his case and somehow overturn the initial case and then somehow win another case. It's pretty unlikely.
Or if, you know, I don't know, whoever's president now or gets elected in 2016 decides to give the guy
him?
A pardon.
Yeah, it's. I'm not sure which of those two outcomes is more unlikely, but they're both fairly unlikely.
U.S. government just dissolves and then all of the prisoners get released because there's no federal government to keep them incarcerated?
Maybe more likely than the other two.
Yeah.
Toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. We're going to continue. You can share your thoughts here. Also, you need to protect yourself online. ProXPN can help you do that. Your ISP is probably monitoring all the websites you visit and logging those sites for, in some cases, as many as 5 years. You can stop that logging from happening. You can stop criminals from sniffing out your Wi-Fi packets. All you have to do is download ProXPN's free app for Windows, Mac, iOS, Android, and Linux. And then you get connected with ProXPN and your internet connection is encrypted. And when you get their premium account, then you also get the ability to privately torrent. You can get unlimited bandwidth and servers around the world that you can access. You get it for 50% off by using code FTL50. And I want to apologize. A listener pointed out something, and we need to change the copy on this ad. But a listener pointed something out. They went to the ProXPN site. The 50% off is actually on the regular monthly price, not the annual price. So I apologize. We've said it wrong a bunch here on Free Talk Live. See, still, you do get 50% off. It's just not on the annual price, which is what I've unfortunately been saying on these radio waves. So please accept my apologies and go and still get the what is a great deal because their regular price is like $10 a month. And so when you buy the annual plan and use code FTL50, then you get 50% off that way. So code FTL50, that gets you the deal. And ProXPN does not keep records of your online habits. Plus, you get it with a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee. Go to proxpn.com/FTL. That's proxpn.com/FTL. And again, promo code FTL50 for a great discount on privacy that is priceless. Mike is in New York. You're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Danica, and Darryl.
Hi, thank you for taking my call.
Go ahead, Mike.
I would like to point out that we've really lost control of our technology in terms of a society. What used to be easy access, I used to be able to open up the old Macintoshes and take them apart and switch out things, and can't do that anymore. Everything's proprietary. Everything's owned by somebody else.
Well, that's not necessarily true. Macintosh has always been, in my experience, fairly proprietary, and it was very difficult to do any kind of servicing on those. But you can still build a computer from parts.
The older machines were easier.
Huh?
Yeah, the older machines were easier.
Okay.
They did build up a fan base. But
you can build a computer for parts today. I still do that with all of mine. Every computer I've ever owned has been hand-built, I mean, with parts ordered separately.
Yeah. You know, but if you want to use specific operating systems or custom things that would help actually, you know, give back some of your privacy.
Oh, we've got that too. I mean, I understand where you're coming from. It's certainly a world in which the federal government has been violating people's privacy. I'm going to grant you that, but all the things you're saying aren't really true. I mean, you can put a specific operating system on a computer that you build. You can put Linux on there. You can put any variant of Linux. You can put whatever version of Windows that you want to. Even Mac. You can even hack together what they call a Hackintosh.
A Hackintosh,
where you can even build your own Mac and then with parts and then put the iOS, some sort of hacked version of the iOS operating system on there or whatever they call it. What do they call it these days? I don't know. I'm not a Mac person. But I know that you can do the Hackintosh.
You could do all that, but the problem is also it's with the software you're using. Not everything's cross-compatible. And I think that I think purposely done.
I wouldn't say that's purposely. I mean, there's no overarching plot to make the different operating systems different. That's just the way the market's provided things. And choices are good, right?
Right, and you know, like same thing with a car. You could go out and if you really wanted to, you could buy a bunch of different parts and build a car, but don't expect a Nissan hubcap to wind up working as the steering wheel of a Chevy.
Well, yeah, they do that all the time, where they swap the engine from one car and put it into the body of another.
Yeah, but don't they do it from like the same brand or whatever? Not necessarily.
Right. So like, Ford Motors will go in other Ford vehicles. If you put a Ford motor in a Chevy, you could make it work, but it's going to be very difficult.
Oh, absolutely. And I would never try and do that myself. But I kind of feel where you're coming from, because cars nowadays have a lot more wiring and electrical technicalities to them, whereas cars from, say, 70s and 80s didn't have that much kind, and it was generally easier to work on cars back then than it is now.
That doesn't even jibe with what he's saying about computers, because computers are easier to work on now than they were in the past. I mean,
saying that, some parts aren't going to work on others, and my point is, a Nissan door is not going to fit on a Ford F-150.
Right.
Well, right, but I think it's important to point out computers are easier to work on now than they were in the past. I mean, they're setting up BIOS, the sort of the underlying system that precludes the operating system. That's even easier now than it's ever been. I remember that was a big pain back in the 1990s, and troubleshooting things. It's just things work better now than they did in the past.
Have YouTube videos to help guide you through it on your phone while you're trying to build your computer.
Yeah, that's true as well. Plus, Google also helps with Googling error messages and things like that. So I got to disagree with pretty much the entire thrust of your call, Mike. Anything else you want to share?
Try and open up a tablet today and then put a different operating system. Try and open up your phone, your iPhone, and try and put a...
Well, I've never done it with a tablet, but I imagine it's very similar. I've done it with every phone I've ever owned, actually. I've rooted every phone that I've ever owned, and I've put on custom operating systems. It's really a very step-by-step process. All you have to do is Google, whatever your phone model is. In my case, I have a S3, a Samsung, and I can Google the model number and, rooting, how to root this phone. And you'll get somebody's out there has already written up a step-by-step guide where you don't even have to know programming or anything. You just follow the steps. Now, there is a risk. You'll brick your phone, as they say. Like if you get a bad guide or you pull up the wrong guide for the wrong phone, but you follow that anyway, there's a chance that this won't work. But every time I've tried it,
worked. And don't you actually have to buy the phone separate from a plan? You can't get a phone on a plan because likely the carrier has already made it so that you can't break the phone.
Oh, no. You can totally jailbreak or root any phone.
Gotcha.
Yeah, there's no way they can prevent that I've seen. Thanks, Mike, for your call tonight. I appreciate it. And once you root a phone, you can, and with the case with Apple, when you jailbreak a phone, you can install software that is unapproved by the Apple Store. In the case of the Android phone, which, of course, will just by default let you install pretty much whatever you want, with the Android phone, you can install certain apps that have capabilities that are unlocked by the rooting of the phone. So, like, Wi-Fi Tether is something that you can get for a rooted phone, which is normally not something that is included in your phone package. You usually have to pay extra for something like that. So, technically, that's a violation of the terms of service of the company that you're with. But they don't know that you're rooting the phone. It's essentially, it's kind of like a hobby. It's a risk that you take. If you do root the phone, Danica, and you are on a service plan, then you will violate the terms of service, and so therefore you can't go back into the store and say
and try and have it fixed for
right.
anything.
Yeah, you can't go into the service center of Verizon and say, "Hey guys, I really botched up. I bricked my phone when I was trying to root it." Well, they'll say, "Well, sorry, you violated your warranty."
Well, sorry, you're not getting a brand new phone then.
Yeah, well, right. We're not going to help you. Essentially, if you want to buy a new phone, that's fine. But we're not going to help you fix the one that you just broke. So there are risks involved in rooting one's phone, but it's totally possible, and it gives you a lot more options and flexibility with the phone. But again, this is sort of like the hobby range here. I mean, if you're just an occasional phone user and you're not like a total geek, this is probably not for you.
Sure.
Because rooting a phone is one thing, and then you can also install these custom operating systems on there, and that's another thing. Sometimes those things work better than others. They're all very experimental. Sometimes they bring you cool features, but they might they might crank out your battery a little bit worse. So you really never know what you're going to get out of this. And so it's very much kind of a tinkerer's hobby, if you will. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number here tonight. More on Ross Ulbricht and the Silk Road still to come on Free Talk Live.
The Atlas Society's Atlas Summit is just around the corner, June 18th through the 21st, right before Porkfest in Nashua, New Hampshire. Connect, grow, have fun with longtime objectivists and people just learning Ayn Rand's philosophy. There are discounts for students, locals, and one-day rates at atlassociety.org. The event is jam-packed with speakers. Come and be a part of the most important objectivist event of the year, the Atlas Summit, June 18th through the 21st, Nashua, New Hampshire, atlassociety.org. 20% off with coupon code FTL, atlassociety.org.
Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com.
Are you suffering from EP? The symptoms include fraudulent charges to your credit card. Your subway card says it's empty, but you bought it yesterday. Someone's been in your hotel room, but the desk clerk says they only show you entering the room. These are signs of EP, electronic pickpocketing. Payment cards, transit cards, even hotel room keys use a radio chip, so you can just wave your card at the register, the turnstile, or your hotel room door. But what's convenient for you is also convenient for thieves, waving scanners to electronically pickpocket you without even touching you. The good news is there's a cure. ID Stronghold has created leather wallets and clutches that have built-in EP protection. Layers of shielding material cleverly concealed in a beautiful leather wallet that stops the symptoms of EP. Go to IDStronghold.com now and get the cure. IDStronghold.com. Warning, ID Stronghold wallets could lead to feelings of safety and security, comfort in crowds, and euphoria. If you experience these emotions, immediately inform your friends and family about IDStronghold.com so they can feel better too.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the liberty media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. Of course, plenty of time for you if you want to join us here at 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. You can join us on our website. Just drop by freetalklive.com and enjoy the features waiting for you there. If you like the show and you like Free Talk Live, you like what we're doing here on the radio waves every night, talking about freedom in a lot of the cases on Free Talk Live, and you want to help us expand this program, get on more radio stations, we are welcoming actually a new station coming up this weekend. Actually, probably, yeah, we'll be welcoming one this weekend, probably another one the weekend after that.
So we can get up to hundreds of stations. We've got over 150 right now. We could have 300, 400, 500. It's all possible. We just have to market the show, and that costs money. So you can help us with that with the AMP program at amp.freetalklive.com. Please, it makes a big difference for us. $5 a month to you, not a whole lot of money, but to us, it adds up. When a bunch of people give us $5, it means we have a marketing budget. And in fact, we'll be going to New York City very soon, me and Mark, and then Darryl and Danica, you guys are going to be here doing the show without me, which is going to be fun. And also, Darryl, you'll be hosting the Thursday edition of that program. That'll be in a couple weeks, so stay tuned for that. And that's the Talkers Convention that Mark and I have now attended. I think this will be our 10th year, maybe in our 9th, but I think our 10th, because I think we started in 05. Anyway, we go and we schmooze with the big wigs and talk radio and hang out with the movers and the shakers. And
this is one of two conventions that Talkers does every year?
They used to do two for a short time, for like three or four years they did two. They did a West Coast and an East Coast one. And they haven't done the West Coast one in the last couple of years. So I don't know if they're bringing that one back. But, you know, we like to go to these things because it helps raise our profile in the industry. And when the big wigs know who you are, that's a good thing.
And you're generally on a panel or two.
Actually, they haven't put me on a panel in a couple of years either. So, I don't know. You never know when they're going to want you back. But, yeah. We still go. I mean, I don't go with the expectation that they're going to put me on a panel, but it's nice when they do.
Right.
But yeah, you can actually see me on the Talk Rumble panel from a few years ago.
Oh, that's cool.
I got to have a, you know, basically an argument with like eight other talk show hosts.
Any big hosts that you've had really good conversations with in years past?
They don't generally get big hosts on the Radio Rumble. Like somebody like Rush Limbaugh is not going to
spend his
time attending that. Now, Alex Jones
is not that big of a name.
No, he's not. He did speak at one of these, actually.
I didn't say it was a big name, just say he's just, you know, kind of known.
It would have been funny.
Within certain circles.
It would have been hilarious to put Alex Jones on the Radio Rumble, but that hasn't happened. And they actually haven't had a Radio Rumble, I don't think, since I was on it. Or at least they stopped it after that. Maybe they did it one year.
You're
after
the
that.
Reigning defending champion.
Nobody's named a winner in the Radio Rumble, so I'm sure they all believe they won when they're up there, knowing the ego of the typical talk show host. So help us out and get perks like access to the AMP Only call-in lines, the AMP Only podcast and Facebook group. Go to amp.freetalklive.com, ampamp.freetalklive.com. We're sharing from wired.com's Andy Greenberg and his summary of the Silk Road sentencing, which happened today. He was charged, Ross Ulbricht, and convicted of several charges, seven felony charges, and two of those seven charges were deemed redundant and dropped by the prosecution just days before the sentencing, though that technical change to the charges didn't lessen Ulbricht's mandatory minimum sentence or his ultimate punishment. Ulbricht's defense team has already said it will seek an appeal in his case. Then that call for the new trial will be based in part on recent revelations that two Secret Service and Drug Enforcement Administration agents that were involved in the investigation of Silk Road allegedly stole millions of dollars worth of Bitcoin from the site. And one of those agents is even accused of blackmailing Ulbricht and of allegedly selling him law enforcement information as a mole inside the DEA. This guy is in some big trouble, this DEA agent. He's facing, I think, multiple felony charges in this case. But the judge in Ulbricht's case ruled those Baltimore-based agents weren't involved in the New York FBI-led investigation that eventually took down the Silk Road, preventing their alleged corruption from affecting Ulbricht's fate. Because if these guys, if this information about these corrupt agents was allowed to be entered into Ross's trial, it could have changed how the jury saw the evidence that was being presented.
Right, because, and I promise I'm not trying to compare Ross Ulbricht to O.J. Simpson, but it was evidence of corruption in the O.J. Simpson murder trial that wound up causing the jury to question all of the evidence.
Yeah, that's right.
So, you know, it is definitely in the favor of the prosecution to hide that evidence and convince the court to not allow that to be brought forth.
So she's saying that because they were involved in a different investigation, they can't use that in this New York.
Well, that was her excuse. I mean, this was a multi-jurisdictional task force that took this guy down.
Right, and the server was in Iceland somewhere, and they found it by magic.
Speaking to press after the sentencing, Ulbricht's lead attorney, Joshua Dreitel, said that Forrest's sentence was unreasonable, unjust, unfair, and based on improper consideration with no basis in fact or law. He said, "I'm disappointed tremendously." In emotional statements at the hearing, the parents of drug users who had overdosed and died from drugs purchased from the Silk Road called for a long sentence for Ulbricht. Quote, "I strongly believe my son would still be alive today if Mr. Ulbricht had never created Silk Road," unquote, said one father whose 25-year-old son had died from an overdose of heroin, requesting, quote, "the most severe sentence the law will allow."
He probably would have died of overdosing from something else.
If Henry Ford had never invented
The Model T.
Well, he didn't invent the automobile. He, you know, streamlined production of the automobile. If he had never done that, there would not be hundreds of thousands of people that die in automobile accidents.
Sure.
Right now.
How many people have died inside a Ford vehicle? Probably countless.
Right.
And should all of the blood of those dead people be on the hands of Henry Ford? And what about everybody who spent the time manufacturing those cars?
Right. And then let's look at other things that kill a lot more people than illegal drugs. And that is legal prescription drugs.
Absolutely.
But yet,
the pharmaceutical companies have special protections where laws are written that says you can't sue a pharmaceutical company in certain circumstances.
Likely that person's son would have died trying to get the drugs and never actually overdosed in the first place. He probably would have gotten killed trying to get the drugs.
Well, it's all speculation. I mean, we don't know. And I don't know, obviously, what the details...
I'm just saying this argument is stupid. His son, knowing that his son was into drugs, probably would have died at some point in his drug journey.
Maybe he would have died sooner had he not been on Silk Road.
Right, because you're getting a more pure drug on the Silk Road.
You get better drugs on the Silk Road.
And you know what you're getting.
More likely to be getting what you order.
Because, you know, you go to some guy on the street, and who knows how many times that product has been cut. You get it the next time, and maybe it was cut one extra time, or not cut one additional time.
That's correct. And then you get an unexpectedly large dose.
Right. Because
if you're taking the same dose of heroin every time, but the percentage of actual heroin in that dose is drastically different from one time to the next, that's how overdoses happen. People generally don't overdose on purpose, but that certainly can happen as well. I mean, maybe this guy's son decided he wanted to just kill himself and figured he'd use some really good heroin in order to do that. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what the situation was. But I think your point's the best one, though, on this, Darryl, that, you know, the manufacturers of products that people have died by should not necessarily be liable for the deaths of those people.
Right. Like, you never see Anheuser-Busch getting sued because some college kid drank too much alcohol and fell off of the rooftop because he said, "Hey, watch me do this."
But you know some people would like that, right? There are some people out there who want to see, you know, the cigarette companies and the alcohol manufacturers and the car manufacturers being liable for the people who die at the hands of their products. But the reason why that can't happen is because there would be no progress, right? Like, the government regulates stuff enough as it is. If it were to the point where every products manufacturer were fully liable for any deaths that happened by the proper use of those products, then they just wouldn't make things because it'd be such a litigious society. I mean, it's incredibly litigious as is, but it would be so bad that you would be so liable for anything, you wouldn't want to make anything. You wouldn't want to put yourself on the line for that. So there's just no chance that those people will ever get that. But in this case, they, you know, drag these poor parents in this courtroom and then had them testify. Ultimately, the judge didn't need to see that. She'd already made up her mind anyway.
She made up her mind before the opening statement was ever uttered by either side.
Yes. In the weeks leading up to his sentencing hearing, Ulbricht's defense team attempted to lighten his punishment with arguments about his motives and character, as well as emphasizing the Silk Road's positive effect on its drug-using customers. In more than 100 letters, friends, family, and even fellow inmates pointed to Ulbricht's idealism and lack of a criminal history. And the defense argued that Silk Road had actually reduced the harm in the drug trade by ensuring the purity of the drugs sold on the site through reviews and ratings, hosting discussions on safe drug use, and giving both buyers and sellers an avenue to trade in narcotics while avoiding the violence of the streets. We'll continue with more. The judge had a thing or two to say about that argument, by the way. We'll share that with you on the way in Hour 3 of Free Talk Live. Coming up.
Have you thought about owning gold? There are lots of reasons to own precious metals. A hedge against inflation. When the dollar tanks, metals go up. A barter currency. You can disempower the Fed by using real money. And no one knows the future. In an economic collapse, metals are likely to be a currency. Do as I've done for years. Buy your gold and silver and precious metals from Midas Resources through gold.freetalklive.com. That's gold.freetalklive.com.
And now, for Geico's edition of Stuff Found in Your Car, we go inside your side door pocket.
Hello, yes, the crumpled receipt with gum in it. From your anniversary dinner, you sprang for expensive wine, your server was Beth. That dinner was a couple $100s. Money you could get back if you switched to Geico and saved hundreds of dollars on your car insurance. I bet you'd save that receipt. Frame it even. But really, where did I go wrong? Was it the corkage fee?
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com today.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com. Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's post pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Darryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 29th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.71 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,188 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $238. Antiwar.com reports the northern Syrian city of Arhiha, the last government-held city of the Idlib province, fell yesterday to al-Qaeda's Nusra Front and its allies, giving them effective control over the entire province. The attack on the city near the Turkish border began earlier in the day with the fall of military checkpoints around the city. Syrian state media reported heavy fighting inside the city. Later, the Syrian government confirmed that the city fell outright, saying the military had moved to defensive positions outside the city after an influx of a large number of Nusra fighters. Pre-war, the city had about 80,000 people, and it lies along a key supply route between Idlib and the coastal Latakia province. Nusra has already made some attempts at Latakia as well, and this will likely make such an offensive easier. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports protesters gathered at six interior border checkpoints in Arizona on Wednesday, where residents argue Border Patrol officials have turned their hometowns into militarized zones. At the Aravica checkpoint, about 35 miles south of Tucson, up to 20 Border Patrol agents were stationed to await the estimated 75 protesters who demand the removal of the checkpoints. Some checkpoints are up to 100 miles away from the border. Patty Miller, an area resident for over 30 years, said through Megaphone, "It seems like a war zone all the time." The organized protest by independent border town community groups focused on issues ranging from the environmental effects of border fences to a checkpoint's intrusion on Native American tribal land. The Aravica checkpoint was established 8 years ago and is the smallest of 11 checkpoints in the Tucson sector. Another protester told the media, "This checkpoint serves as a deterrent to living in Aravica." Manuel Padilla, chief patrol agent of the Border Patrol in the Tucson sector, was at the Aravica checkpoint and said checkpoints like these help secure Arizona and monitor illegal immigration. He added, "It's legal to run the checkpoints. If someone has a disagreement with the law, there are channels to express that." You can support FPP Radio by shopping online. Whether you're looking for precious metals, bitcoins, or books, you'll find that and more at shop.fppradio.com. Or you can shop directly from FPP with Bitcoin in the Bitcoin store. Every purchase you make from one of my affiliates at shop.fppradio.com helps fund FPP Radio. Reuters reports former Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives, Dennis Hastert, was indicted on Thursday on federal charges, including for lying to the FBI relating to an alleged effort to hide $3.5 million in payments he was making to a person to conceal past misconduct. The U.S. Attorney's Office in Chicago said the Illinois Republican, who left Congress in 2007, was charged with structuring the withdrawal of $952,000 in cash to evade the requirements that bank report transactions over $10,000 and lying to the FBI about the withdrawals. Each count of the two-count indictment carries a maximum penalty of 5 years in prison and a $250,000 fine. Hastert resigned on Thursday from the Dickstein Shapiro law firm in Washington, where he was listed as a senior advisor, and from the board of the exchange operator CME Group Incorporated, according to representatives of both the law firm and CME. Hastert could not be reached immediately to comment on the indictment. According to the indictment, the unspecified misconduct involved payments to an unnamed individual who had been a Yorkville, Illinois resident and had known Hastert for most of the person's life. According to the indictment, Hastert met with the person several times around 2010 and discussed past misconduct by the former lawmaker. Eventually, Hastert agreed to pay the person $3.5 million in compensation to conceal the misconduct. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Already struggling to get by on the basic necessities of day-to-day life, lunatics across the nation confirmed today that they are now barely able to afford the quickly rising price of car meat.
I've got 14 Barbara Streisands to feed and three more on the way. Day and night they shout, "We're hungry, Admiral. We want grade A Honda loaf. We want Nissan truck."
I just want to know what Bruno Mars plans to do about this. He sits around all day eating Audi ribeye and limousine bouillabaisse while we scrape by with taxi shanks. Meanwhile, the men at arms are still overseas fighting the war on Wheel of Fortune.
For more on this story, check this week's Onion Review.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live. Not a very happy edition of the show. We're talking about Ross Ulbricht and the life sentence that he has received for the dastardly crime of coding a website. That's right. He wrote the Silk Road. He was the creator of the Silk Road, and he admitted as much through his defense attorney in the opening statement at his trial, which happened in January, I think it was. That's when it started. It was
January.
4 or 5 week long trial, and we followed it in quite a bit of detail here on Free Talk Live. And a lot of that detail was thanks to Andy Greenberg at Wired.com for doing such excellent writing and keeping a real close watch on things. Plus, John Bush and the crew over at the Liberty Beat also did a fine job of reporting from the trial as well. So thanks to everybody who actually went there and tried to help out. There was, of course, our friends like Derek J. Freeman, who went down and as an activist and ultimately was turned away by Ross and his mother and an attorney asking them to leave because the judge was threatening the jurors, threatening to lock them away, basically, in a hotel, sequestering them from any outside contact whatsoever, not allowing them to go home at the end of the night, which would make the jury think that they were under a threat from some drug kingpin who wanted to snuff them out.
Right, and why would they think otherwise? Because that's one of the charges.
Well, not in that case, but they were alleging that Ross was hiring hitmen
Right, but no, one of the charges was that Ross Ulbricht was a kingpin.
Oh, that, right, the kingpin. Mm-hmm. But I thought you meant the murder charges, which they...
No.
Yeah, they were...
They were told, like, you know, he had a murder for hire.
Multiple. They were tarring him with this idea that he's some sort of murderous person.
Even though he was never charged with a murder for hire.
And still hasn't been, from my understanding. So there's a little bit more... Well, there's actually a little bit more here from Andy Greenberg, and then also the letter... from Ross Ulbricht that we did read on the air here on Free Talk Live, but ultimately was suppressed. I have now re-released over at freekeen.com. So you heard earlier this week, we read the letter that Ross wrote to the judge in the for the sentencing in this case, which ultimately had no effect on this tyrannical woman who gave him life in prison. But I'm talking about the first letter that was released publicly from Ross Ulbricht, which was sent to an activist here in Keene, which was then brought to me, and I had put it online in, I think it was March 1st. I put it on freekeen.com. Subsequently, and we did read it on the air that night, subsequently his mom asked me to remove that content, and ultimately I didn't want to because, you know, I feel like that was, I felt like it was news and that it was important to get that out. The news, basically, the letter essentially vindicated the activists because I had always wondered, what did Ross want? Because we knew his mom talked to the activists who went out to his trial and said, look, we would like you to not come back. We would like you to, or at the very least, don't protest. Don't stand outside. Don't do jury outreach. Don't hold any signs. Or the judge is going to make the jury think that Ross is trying to kill them, basically. And so that was enough to convince people to call it quits. Derek J was planning on staying there the entire week. For the first week at least, maybe even longer. He came home the next day.
Yep.
Because, and he was so disappointed.
Yeah, he was really sad.
He and others had taken time out of their lives to come and, you know, take a risk. When you're out in front of a courthouse holding a sign or giving out jury information, there's a chance they're going to arrest you as well, especially at this courthouse, which arrested Julian Heiklin for doing the very same thing a couple of years previous.
Right, and the other risk, and this is one that wasn't talked about as much, if the people that were there with the sign saying, you know, like, don't cage a man for running a website,
right,
were seen interacting with the people that had the jury nullification signs and jury nullification information, then they could have gotten charged, all of them collectively, with some sort of racketeering.
Oh, really?
Because then you've got two different types of outreach that... they're working together, they're cooperating to say, here's jury nullification information. And by the way, this guy is being charged with running a website. And see that guy over there with that sign?
Yeah.
So they had to make sure that they did not communicate while they were in front of that courthouse.
Yeah, it was very cautious of them, but I can't say I blame them in that case. So they ultimately, in the case of the activists who went back home, were pretty disappointed, but a lot of people were wondering, was that what Ross really wanted? Because all they knew at the time was that it was Ross's mom who was coming to them saying, hey, I don't want this to happen to my son. I don't want the judge to punish the jury, so please just go home, guys. That's what the attorneys said. That's what I'm saying.
Everyone was so doubtful of the defense method. It was, oh, it's,
well,
crazy.
Yeah, and it turns out Ross did support having the activists go home. I mean, he basically told me that when he called me to ask me to remove the article that I put up, because what I told his mom was, look, I'll edit the article a little bit, like removing a certain line from his letter, but I'm not going to pull the letter until I hear it from Ross that this is what he wants. And they actually did get Ross to call me here in the LRN.FM studio one day, and he did personally ask me to take the letter down, so I did that. I have since reposted that letter as of now because of the sentencing. The idea was that if the judge saw his letter, that, you know, if the prosecution printed this letter out and then the judge saw it, then the judge would, you know, not look as favorably on him if she might, you know, if she was going to look favorably, which I didn't believe for a moment that she was going to look favorably. But I didn't want to upset Lynn too much, and I certainly didn't want to upset Ross.
Right.
And so I went ahead and pulled the letter. At this point, he's been sentenced to life in prison. I figure it's fair to put that letter online again. So if you want to see that letter, the actual original scanned copy is back. It's over at freekeen.com. You can grab it there, where he says that even though he, you know, ultimately decided to not have the activists there, he did say, I'm glad you were there protesting. You should be able to voice your opinions and hold signs, especially at a courthouse where it's especially important to have that freedom. I know it was touchy because the judge wanted to control what the jury was exposed to, but I don't think you did anything wrong, and I appreciate you trying to help, even though I was found guilty in the end. So he appreciated the activists' efforts, which I thought, you know, they didn't know that at that time. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was important information to get out. So it wasn't like he was against necessarily what they were doing. He was just scared. And his mom certainly was scared. And, you know, when mom's scared, that'll transfer a little bit, right? That'll transfer to a son. Like, you don't like seeing mom scared. So
right.
Certainly.
You know, you try to stop that from happening. And now I'm sure his mom's pretty upset. She's going to be coming to the Porcupine Freedom Festival. She gave a great speech at the Liberty Forum this year, these are the two yearly events that the Free State Project puts on. Of course, the Free State Project is a movement to try to get 20,000 people to sign up to pledge to make the move to New Hampshire, like we did. The three of us here are Free State Project participants, and we've enjoyed these Liberty Forums and Pork Fests in previous years. Lynn Ulbricht was at Porkfest last year, and she's going to be back there this year speaking on all of this and, you know, the whole experience, I'm sure. So if you want to meet Lynn, then come to Porkfest. Go to porkfest.com, PORCFEST.com. We'll be there broadcasting live. Free Talk Live is going to be there every single night broadcasting the program as we do every year at Porkfest. It's a great festival. It's a kind of a week-long camping party in the woods with over 1,500 liberty-oriented people, everything from family events to parties like Buzz's Big Gay Dance Party and more. It's a lot of fun. So come on and join us at porkfest.com. We'll look forward to it. It's at the end of June, by the way, the last week in June.
21st through 28th.
Thank you.
Are you giving any presentations this year?
Probably. It's one of those things where somebody asks me to do something and then I sort of find myself on the schedule later and like, oh yeah, that's what I'm supposed to be here to do. But no, I don't really remember, honestly. If I'm going to get, I don't know, maybe I'm not. I'm not sure. I'm not doing the radio thing this year, I don't think. Nobody
yeah, I know that's been the main one that you've done the last several years is like, you know, how to run a pirate radio station.
Nobody asked me to do it, so I'm not doing it. Anyway, toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. So back to the story here. Over at Wired.com, we had talked about Ross Ulbricht and the 100-plus letters that were submitted on his behalf asking for leniency, asking for the minimum sentence, which would have been 20 years. He could have had some kind of a life at being released at age 50. Now he's going to be in for life. And in the prosecution side of things was that any protection the Silk Road offered drug users was dwarfed by the increased access that it offered to dangerous and addictive drugs. Because, again, the defense was arguing that the Silk Road helped people, which is what we've said here on Free Talk Live. And beyond the two parents who spoke at the Friday hearing, it pointed to six individuals who it claimed had died of drug overdoses from drugs purchased on the Silk Road. In her statement preceding Ulbricht's sentencing, Judge Forrest fully sided with the prosecution against the defense's harm reduction argument, arguing that the Silk Road vastly expanded access to drugs. And we'll get her exact quote coming up here in moments. 855-450-FREE. More on the Silk Road sentencing, which happened today. It's Free Talk Live.
I'm Steve Sitkowski, a former Wall Street insider. I'm holding a book that will show you investing strategies which could help you earn the kind of money you've always dreamed about. And right now, I'm giving this book away for free. So who needs to read it? If you're in the middle of your career and worry you'll never have enough money to retire, you need to read this book. If you're already retired and your income isn't enough, you need to read this book. And if you don't want to be selling burgers at 80, you need to read this free book. It includes the strategy I use to make a 72% profit on a trade where the stock only moved 12%. You'll need at least $1 million to ever fully retire. If you're behind on that goal, you really need to read Trade Like the Pros. And you can for free by calling 1-800-944-5836. Skeptical that it will deliver results? It's a free book, so what do you have to lose? Find out how at 1-800-944-5836. 1-800-944-5836.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm. Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us here. You can talk about the Ross Ulbricht sentencing. You weren't really surprised, were you? If you were surprised by the Ross Ulbricht sentence, then you must be new to this program, because there's so much outrageous behavior on the part of the government, and we've seen so many cases where people who've been disobedient to the state have been punished nearly to the maximum, or in this case, to the maximum, and that is the ultimate crime, as Darryl was pointing out earlier. Not doing what you're told, not staying in line, and, you know, being obedient. That's what they want out of you. They want your obedience, and they want your money. And we don't give them the money, then they come after you. And if you don't give them obedience, they come at you even harder. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number here tonight. With you, Ian.
Danica.
And Darryl.
Don't forget to join us online at freetalklive.com and uncovering the secrets and exposing the lies. That's what the readers of freedomsphoenix.com get every day. Readers of freedomsphoenix.com are provided the detailed real news that lies between the lines of propaganda and the relationship we have with coercive governments. FreedomsPhoenix.com offers up-to-the-minute updates on the economy, technology, communications, and the rise of the police state. Go now to FreedomsPhoenix.com and sign up for the free daily dispatch. That's FreedomsPhoenix.com. As we continue here with Wired.com's Andy Greenberg, he's writing a good summary piece here about the sentencing today of Ross Ulbricht, the heroic man who was operating the Silk Road, the creator of the Silk Road. He says that he went away from the site for a period of time, for a long while, handed it over to another operator, and or the operator bought him out or something like that. We don't know all those details because that side of the story was not able to be presented in court. The judge basically prevented the defense from putting on a defense. And that was unfortunate. I think it was also a mistake that Ulbricht did not testify. The first time that he was heard speaking was today in court at his sentencing, where he was begging the judge for mercy. So the jury never got to hear from Ross.
They never got to connect with him. I thought that was a mistake that happened in the Rich Paul trial, which is our friend and co-host on the program. Rich never spoke during his trial either to the jury. He didn't testify. He didn't get to look, you know, and connect with the jury eye to eye and, you know, make that human level connection. He just sat, you know, and Ross just sitting there as a defendant. You're this just quiet person, and the defense attorney does all the talking. And the defendant, you never really get to know the person. You only get to know them through the claims of the defense attorney. And I feel like, yes, I know it's risky for someone to get on the stand and testify, but Ross Ulbricht was already risking it all. You might as well get up there and explain yourself to these people. But he didn't. And so they found him guilty. And maybe they would have found him guilty anyway. But as was pointed out by James Babb, an activist from Philly, how could it have been worse than what it was?
Right. And this is one of those cases to where hindsight is definitely 20/20. To where looking back, well, he got, you know, the worst punishment possible. It couldn't have gone any differently. But it's sort of like a, you know, armchair quarterbacking sort of thing, to where you're looking back and saying, oh, well, if you just would have done this differently, then you could have wound up winning.
Now, wasn't Ross given the chance to take the stand, or in his defense?
You always have the chance.
The defense advised against, told him not to, correct?
Almost always the defense attorney will advise you against taking the stand because you could incriminate yourself. You know, you can accidentally answer questions that could make the case harder for you to win.
Yeah.
So it's a risky thing to get up there. But again, he was already at severe risk anyway.
Right.
And I firmly believe, and you know, this isn't just hindsight is 20/20. I was advocating for it during the trial. You know, I thought that he should take the stand during the trial.
Right. I'm not saying that your statement just now was, but in some ways, someone could perceive it that way. Mm-hmm. Of, oh, well, you're just saying, you know, he should have done this because you know how it turned out.
Yeah, no, I think that he should have done it regardless, because I think it was the only chance at convincing these people. I mean, you got on the stand, or not on the stand, but your attorney gets up at the beginning of the trial and says you're Dread Pirate Roberts and then you started the website. At that point, you've got to explain yourself.
Right.
You're going to get convicted. You know, it doesn't matter if you can throw out some of the evidence. You know, if you get up and challenge every piece of evidence that the feds bring up and are successful in throwing 70% of it out, it doesn't matter. You already admitted to committing, you know, 4 out of the 7 crimes right there.
Right.
So why not explain yourself? Why not, you know, give them your mindset, the rationale? It's not going to work, likely, but at the very least, it would give you a semblance of a chance. Maybe a 1% chance.
Well, like you said, it would allow you to connect with the jury and make them see, hey, look at this guy.
Well, for what that's worth, you're probably not going to convince all 12. But if you can just convince one, if you can convince one juror to vote not guilty, then it's worth it. Anyway, going on here, what does the judge have to say? Because we know that the defense said that, well, Ross Ulbricht helped people. He protected people. The Silk Road helped keep people safe. Now, the prosecution, of course, argued differently. It said that people died because of the drugs that they bought on the Silk Road and that he expanded the access to drugs. So in her her statement preceding the sentencing, Judge Forrest fully sided with the prosecution, saying, quote, "Silk Road was about fulfilling demand, and it was about creating demand," she said. "It was market expanding." She also tore into, because there's just so many people out there just waiting to try heroin. They've just been waiting their whole lives to try heroin, and now finally the Silk Road has come around, and now they get to try heroin. I don't imagine there were very many people who were first-time hard drug users who went on to the Silk Road to buy things like heroin and crack. I'm sure there's somebody. You can probably find a story or two of somebody who was, I've never tried heroin before. And then they bought some on the Silk Road. But your typical heroin user, somebody who is, you know, going to be attracted to heroin, has probably already used, and then they found out about the Silk Road.
Right.
And it's a way for them to get their drugs safer. It's a way for them to get a better quality product. And they're not risking being on the streets and risking arrest and risking robbery for getting things in the black market. She also, the judge, tore into the argument that the Silk Road reduced violence in the drug trade, pointing out that most of the academic papers submitted by the defense to support the argument focused only on the protection for the final buyer of drugs. But that digital remove, she argued, did nothing to prevent violence at any other point in the narcotics supply chain, from production to distribution. She said, quote, "The idea that it's harm reducing is so very narrow. It's about a privileged group sitting in their own homes with their own high-speed internet connections." 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number here tonight.
I wonder how this judge would have ruled during Prohibition on if somebody had made a safer way to deliver alcohol to people that wanted to drink alcohol when it was prohibited by the U.S. Constitution.
Alcohol is bad, okay?
Well, you know, the judge
maybe... Well, they're still making gin in the bathtub, and that's bad.
Well, yeah, right. So the judge is basically acknowledging that the defense is correct in that this has reduced harm for some people. And then she dismisses
them.
But
it's only some people. It's not everybody.
But it doesn't matter. People still died.
She dismisses them. She says it's a privileged group sitting in their own homes with their high-speed internet connections. So those poor people in the streets who are still buying their drugs on the street corner, Ross Ulbricht's discriminating against those people. He should have protected them too. I mean, what, it's just a ridiculous statement from this judge.
Totally ridiculous.
We'll come back with more, and you can share your thoughts at 855-450-FREE. Free Talk Live.
Hi, this is Steve Sanchez, and based on a recent study, it was found that 57 million Americans had legal issues over the last 12 months, but only 60% of those studied sought out the services of a lawyer. Why? In a nutshell, affordability. Well, my friends at Legal Shield have created a solution that can help you not if, but when you need an attorney. For as little as $17 per month, Legal Shield will provide you unlimited access to qualified attorneys at an accomplished law firm for advice and counsel on legal issues, no matter how serious or trivial. For over 40 years and with 1.4 million families across North America, Legal Shield can help you, the loyal GCN listener. Representatives are standing by now to answer your questions, so call them now at 1-855-340-SAVE. That's 1-855-340-7283, or visit them at lsprotection.com. That's lsprotection.com.
Results will vary from case to case.
My name is Angel Rach. I'm a mother of two teenage children, and I fought all the way to the Supreme Court for the right to use the medicine that saved my life. I've been permanently disabled for 10 years, with an inoperable brain tumor, wasting syndrome, and several other serious conditions. For 4 years, I was in a wheelchair, in so much pain, I couldn't even hug my kids. The hardest part was looking in their eyes and seeing how much they were suffering because of my medical condition. The medicine that gave me my life back and gave my kids their mom back was cannabis, also known as medical marijuana. With medical marijuana, I can walk, maintain my weight, and I can be a mom. Without it, my doctors believe that I would die. To learn more about medical marijuana, contact Marijuana Policy Project at 1-877-JOIN-MPP or on the web at mpp.org.
Did you know that FreeAid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At FreeAid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. FreeAid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The FreeAid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com. Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me.
who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here. And I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
All right, we got a correction to make here. Daryl's done some digging and pulled up some numbers, some comparisons on the darknet markets to see how many thousands of listings there are now versus at, you know, like a few months back or a couple years ago or whatever. Because I had made the statement earlier that there are more drugs listed online now than ever before. And apparently I was off by a few thousand.
Maybe not, because that did not specify just drugs. That was listings on black market sites.
Still.
And that number is about 3,300 less than what it was in August of last year.
But it's still close. What was it in August of last year? These are total listings, so including weapons, fake IDs.
Total listing last August was 46,900, and now it's 43,600.
So that's a huge, huge number. And so it's near to a record number of listings. And that 46,000 number that you cited there, that was right before the takedown of Silk Road 2.0, correct?
I think so.
Yeah, because if you look at the, I don't know if you saw the graphic in front of you, but you can see that that is a very tall chart, and then it has in it Silk Road 2.0, and then the next chart does not have Silk Road 2.0. So once Silk Road 2.0 got taken down, that was a major blow to the black markets. But some of these black markets are right up to where the Silk Road 2.0 was. Because on this chart, and if you could, maybe post that onto our Facebook and Google.
Yeah, I'll pull that back up. I've closed the tab, but I'll definitely post the link.
Yeah, I thought it was an interesting link because it actually shows you in a sort of a bar graph how many listings each one of the sites has. Now, there are sites that have charts that compare those things too, but I kind of like the layout of the look there. And what I guess...
Yeah, that chart was actually put together by The Economist.
Do you have it? Did you pull it back up?
Yeah, I just pulled it back up.
So what's the when is the most recent numbers from on that chart?
Give me just a second. The most recent numbers were April of this year. It does not specify a date in April.
Yeah,
but it says April of 2015. The largest marketplace is Agora,
and how many listings?
Almost 17,000.
That's a lot.
Wow.
And that's actually more than what Silk Road had in October of 2013.
That was going to be my question.
And almost as many as the total number of listings in October of 2013.
Wow. Now that was at
there
the very end
of
Silk Road.
18,200. And you are correct. This is only drug listings.
Oh, it is? Oh,
yes.
Okay,
so it's not covering fake IDs or anything like that.
Right, so this is not total listings, which is what I thought it was.
Ah, still very interesting.
That's still a lot.
Yeah, it is a lot, and it's like right now, right at all through 3,000 listings away from being a world record, basically. And so the government has done nothing in its crackdown on Silk Road 1, 2.0, and the other various sites, because other sites have been taken down. Oh, and there was, you know what? There was the Evolution market that went under recently as
Evolution in March had 19,900, so almost 20,000.
And they disappeared.
They disappeared, and I heard something weird about them to where, like, they just disappeared and
took
everybody's
money. Yeah, they took the money and ran, which, you know, isn't such a bad idea, right? I mean, I don't advocate this. It is fraudulent, and it's not okay, but we're talking about an underground marketplace, right? If you've got an underground marketplace, and Evolution was a very popular one, it was one of the top two or three at the time that it went down.
It was number one, according to this chart.
Oh, I didn't realize it had beaten out Agra. Well, anyway, it must
have... Or at least based on drug listings.
Okay. Yeah, it must have just beaten out Agra, because Agra was number one for a long while. Anyway, that, you know, if you've got the number one or number two drug market, and you're rolling in the dough, I mean, there's Bitcoin coming in every day by the hundreds, right? Like, you've got a lot of money coming in. It's got to be real tempting to just say, all right, see ya. And,
right.
You know, you're already under attack by the federal government. You know they're after you. You know that the other websites are probably trying to crack, you know, the hackers or whatever, they're trying to crack your security. It's a constant battle. I mean, this Ross Ulbricht was in his room all day long working on his website, basically, in a lot of instances. I mean, it was a lot of time that he had to spend trying to put out fires and make sure the site continued to work, because it was under attack from multiple fronts. I mean, that's going to get exhausting. And you might as well quit while you're on top. Now, did they do it in the best way? No.
No.
I mean, the right way to do it would have been to say, okay, guys, we're shutting it down in 2 weeks. You know, give people at least some notice. Now, there will still be people who don't log in often, and they might, you know, not log in that 2 week time frame and then try to log in on the third week after you've taken the site down, and then they're upset about it. But, you know, you can't make everybody happy when you're shutting down a business like that. But how else do you exit this business, right? You can't go forever.
Right.
The longer you go, the closer you're going to get to an arrest.
Yes.
So, all things considered, they did better than the people who got arrested, right? They walked away with probably millions of dollars worth of Bitcoin from that operation, and no one knows who they are or where they are.
And according to this chart, Agora has been around since at least April of 2014.
I thought they started pretty much immediately after Silk Road went away. I'm pretty sure they've been around since late 2013.
Okay, well,
like December range.
The chart here shows October 2013.
Yep.
And then the next listing that it has is April of 2014.
Got it.
So they don't show anything November, December, January, February, or March. Gotcha.
A little bit more from Andy Greenberg over at Wired Magazine. The Justice Department argued in their letter that letter to Judge Forrest that Ulbricht should be made an example of, so that it'll stop more dark web market kingpins from following in his footsteps.
Oh, right, like it's stopping Agora, Nucleus, yeah. Black Bank, Alpha Bay, the 1, 2, 3, 7 others that
and other sites
aren't
that
even listed by name on this chart that I'm looking at.
Those are smaller listings.
After all, dozens of copycat sites and advancements on the Silk Road market model have sprouted in the years since its takedown, including the Silk Road 2, Evolution, and the currently largest dark web black market to survive law enforcement's attacks, Agora. To combat the spread of those anonymous bazaars, prosecutors asked Judge Forrest to send a clear message with a sentence for Ulbricht well beyond the mandatory minimum. Judge Forrest sided with the prosecution on that point, arguing she needed to create a strong deterrent for the next Dread Pirate Roberts, saying, quote, "For those considering stepping into your shoes, they need to understand without equivocation that there will be severe consequences," said Forrest. The defense's arguments about Ulbricht's character and his idealistic motives were also undercut by accusations that Ulbricht had paid for the murder of 6 people, including a potential informant and blackmailer. Those accusations never became formal charges in Ulbricht's case. 5 out of 6 of the murder-for-hires appear to have been part of a lucrative scam targeting Ulbricht, with no actual victims. But those murder accusations nonetheless deeply colored Ulbricht's trial and strongly influenced his sentence. Forrest said, quote, "I find there is ample and unambiguous evidence that Ulbricht commissioned 5 murders to protect his commercial enterprise." Well, the evidence, lady, was some chat logs, which could have been fabricated by the very same corrupt DEA agent who was trying to fool Ulbricht into thinking that he needed to kill someone.
Right, and one of the chat logs was the DEA agent saying, "Hey, you need to go kill this guy."
As another character, the DEA agent playing someone else. Forrest leaving out one alleged murder charge for which Ulbricht was charged in a different case. With those attempted murders as context, Forrest was merciless in her assessment of Ulbricht's seeming multiple personalities. The altruistic and admirable young man described in the letters sent to her as evidence of his character versus the callous drug lord she saw in his actions. She said, quote, "People are very complicated, and you are one of them. There is good in you, Mr. Ulbricht. There is also bad. And what you did with the Silk Road was terribly destructive."
Now, maybe there's some good in this judge, but I haven't seen it in this case. This woman has been an absolute harridan from beginning to end. She has been absolutely horrible, a total arch statist, and doesn't appear to have much humanity in her. It's nice that she can acknowledge that there's some good in Ross, but to, you know, her viewpoint is the Silk Road's destructive. I totally disagree. I think it's incredibly constructive. It created opportunities for people to be safer with their drug use and their drug buying, and the world is better off because of it. Ross should be given an award. He should be released from prison, and they should give him an official apology. But that would be an ideal world, and we're not living in that one. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number. We have time for you if you want to get your thoughts into this discussion, or whatever you want.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used, and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online, and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com.
Yuvia needed financing to grow her restaurant business, but her bank simply didn't understand.
I was frustrated.
Yuvia found On Deck Business Loans.
On Deck did it for me. I called on Saturday, and I had $50,000 in my account on Monday morning.
How about the terms?
Incredibly easy. It doesn't mess with your cash flow.
On Deck changed everything.
This company, On Deck, is going to be there for me.
Was it a good move?
I'm looking to increase sales probably 30%.
Been in business for at least a year with $100,000-plus in revenue? On Deck can get you $5,000 to $250,000. In as little as one business day, and they're A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau.
On Deck has opened up so many doors for me now. Truly, the sky is the limit. I'm excited.
Apply now at OnDeckLending.com or call 800-326-5430. 800-326-5430. 800-326-5430.
Loan subject to lender approval.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. Physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101ReasonsFilm.com. 101ReasonsFilm.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com. This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at LRN.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You can join us online at freetalklive.com. You can join us via Skype here on the airwaves. Skype username is lrn.fm. And our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And joining you here in studio in the remaining moments of Free Talk Live, I'm Ian.
I'm Danica.
And I am Darryl.
All right. We'll continue here a little bit more from Andy Greenberg over at Wired.com and his wrap-up piece after Ross Ulbricht, the creator of the Silk Road, the world's most infamous underground drug marketplace, is going to prison for life. Well, he's staying in prison. He's been there the last year and a half, waiting trial, which happened in January and February this year. He was found guilty by a jury of his so-called peers in an incredibly unfair trial. And now sentenced to life without parole. It's terrible. Hopefully he will be successful in appealing, but don't get your hopes up. The system is not designed to be fair to the people that it abuses like this. And it's exactly what, by the way, just to wrap back around to what I said in the beginning of the show, it's exactly what the federal prisoners predicted. We read a letter earlier this week from a federal prisoner in Marion, Illinois, and I've received two letters from the federal prisoners in this particular prison. And both of them by different people who said the exact same thing, that because Ross didn't take a plea, he's going to get nailed to the wall, that the judge would give him the max. This guy said in his letter he would be surprised if Ross gets anything less than life. And he was absolutely right. And now the a big question is, where is Ross going to end up? You know, they can put him in any facility they want to. It's not that they don't have to put him near his parents. In fact, his parents, I think, live out in Austin or whatever, or in California, some other place like that. And he's been in Manhattan the entire time, so they've had to travel quite a bit and incur a lot of costs. When Mark Emery was put in federal prison, I don't know if you remember Mark. He's the Prince of Pot. He's the publisher of Cannabis Culture magazine out of Vancouver. They seemed to purposely put him as far away from his wife as they could. They put him in Georgia for a good period of his 5 years, or Mississippi, one of those southeastern states. They put him in a federal prison.
Somewhere that's nowhere close to Canada.
A very long way away.
And as far away from Vancouver as possible, right? Like, that's the other side of the entire continent.
Yeah.
So, you know, they made it as difficult on Jody as possible to get to see her husband, and he was only found guilty of selling some seeds. He was found guilty.
Over the internet, though.
Yeah.
When you use the internet for anything, it makes it 10 times worse.
Well, at least they didn't send him a 50-year message. He was sentenced to 5 years in that particular case. So now Ross is going in for a long time. And so that's a question, is where is he going to end up? What we learned about this week was the what they call the Communication Management Unit. They have two of these things in the federal prison. So of all the federal prisons, they have two communications management units. And the way it was described is the prisoner who was writing to us was in this unit. And so the way it was described was they have total lockdown on your communications. Because in a lot of places you can communicate, you can like send a letter and it won't be read, for instance. Like here in the jail in Cheshire County, you can send a letter out and they won't read it. But letters coming in, they will read. At the communication management unit in the federal prison, all outgoing letters are screened. Every single word is screened. They will reject your letter if you reveal certain information about your case that they have told you you cannot reveal. So the guy who wrote to us couldn't give us details about what had actually happened to him, certain things about that. Couldn't talk about that. And every phone call they make, only two allowed per week, only two 15-minute calls per week per prisoner. Wow. Every call is monitored by a live monitoring counterterrorism team. Every piece of mail is screened by that counterterrorism team. So it's total lockdown on communications, near total lockdown.
I'm still wondering, and I'm not necessarily advocating that somebody in one of these communication units do this, but I'm still wondering if you can do subliminal messaging through your mail. So, and I did this one time when...
You mean coding or subliminal messaging?
Kind of both. What I did one time when I was in high school, I got in trouble and had to like write something on five sheets of paper, like the same thing, like repeat this. So what I did was I would just capitalize certain letters and spell out words.
Sure. It's a pretty common code, right? Like they'll figure that one out maybe.
So, you know, just like only read the capital letters.
Right.
But if you do it in such a way to where it's not super obvious,
yeah,
then you know you might be able to slip something through.
If you're putting capital letters like at the start of every sentence, like you should be, then probably not.
They're gonna find something like that. That's a pretty basic coding meme.
Yeah, because mine, it was like, you know, a letter in the middle of the word would be capitalized.
What you'd want to do is have some sort of prearranged system of, you know, certain letters that you would that the person would know to look for in a certain number of or whatever certain words into the letter, like word number 7 and word number 20 and things like that, like some sort of arbitrary code that was completely
right.
made up and then posted with your loved ones to where you couldn't you know obviously you wouldn't be able to tell them what the code was once you're inside the jail. So
whatever the first letter of the very first word I use will tell you which word to look for. So the letter A, look for the first word that I write after this.
Oh, the first. Okay,
if
gotcha.
I use the letter L, then look for like the 12th word. Or, you know, come up with some kind of safe word to where something that you would not normally say but could be used in a sentence to where if somebody's reading the sentence, they're not going to be like, oh, yeah, this is obviously code.
What's your safe word, Darryl?
Too much information. All right. So a little bit more here from the judge. She says, what you did with Silk Road, Mr. Ulbricht, was terribly destructive. Well, maybe she didn't finish the sentence. Maybe what she meant was that it was terribly destructive to the legitimacy of the state's war on drugs. I mean, isn't that what she actually meant, right? Because he didn't destroy people's lives. He made people's lives better.
That's what she meant, but she's never going to say that.
Right. That's exactly what she's talking about. Mm-hmm. It's destructive for people to not obey. It's destructive not only for them not to obey, but for them to shout it from the digital rooftops. I mean, Ross Ulbricht, as Dread Pirate Roberts, presuming it was him the whole time, was an advocate for liberty. I don't think people should forget that about him. We haven't mentioned it a whole lot here in these discussions. He was a libertarian. He had a reading list. There was a section of the forums on the Silk Road. There's Silk Road website, and then there were the Silk Road forums. And there was a whole section in there devoted to talking about Dread Pirate Roberts' reading list. What was Dread Pirate Roberts recommending that people read this week on the Silk Road? They were talking about that. These, you know, people who were users of the website would also pick up the books that Ross would recommend and, you know, learn things about libertarianism and economics.
So what were some of the books he recommended?
Oh, I don't know. I didn't spend that much time in the forums. I mean, I knew it was there. I wasn't a member of his book club, I guess you could say. I'm already a libertarian, so I didn't really pay close attention.
Right, but, you know, like a couple of years ago, Rand Paul had a reading list on his website. Mm-hmm. And then he removed a bunch of books from that just before he announced he was running for president. And like some of the books were The Revolution, a manifesto written by his father that was on his reading list and now no longer is.
So a quick Google search of Dread Pirate Roberts' reading list. Let's see. According to the Huffington Post, they aren't likely to be books on the agenda for your mom's next book club meeting, but they don't actually say there what he
I'm
offered.
Just curious if he had, like, you know, Frederick Bastiat's The Law, if he had
Atlas Shrugged,
Lysander Spooner's No Treason, The Constitution of No Authority.
Anatomy of the State by Murray Rothbard.
Okay.
So there's one of them and others. So in other news here, or the remainder of the story, her sentencing statement, Forrest denied even that the Silk Road was a naive experiment or some sort of youthful mistake. She said, quote, "It was a carefully planned life's work. It was your opus. You wanted it to be your legacy, and it is." And then she rudely put him in prison for the rest of his life. He's 29 years old.
31.
31? Oh, I'm sorry.
He was 29 when he was arrested.
Yeah, he's 31 now.
So he's had birthdays.
He's still fairly young.
Yeah, he's a young man.
Yeah.
And it's tragic. Any other thoughts you guys want to add into to this? Something we missed?
I just can't believe she's taken his entire life away. Like, he's spending the rest of his life.
Oh, she's going to get an award. She's going to get some sort of judge's honor for this.
She'll probably wind up getting promoted. She's probably, like, doing everything she can to get one of the seats on prison. The U.S. Supreme Court after Ginsburg or whoever it is.
It's big for her.
It's disgusting.
Right. This is a big career move for this judge. And even if she gets overturned, which she won't. Anyway, we're out of time for tonight. Check out Darryl on his website, fpp.cc. He's got a newspaper and radio shows and stuff.
Don't forget, use code ROSS and 10% of your purchase this weekend goes to the Ross Ulbricht Defense Fund.
And donate at freeross.org.
If you're looking for work, the person you are applying to is probably so swamped with applicants that he or she is tough to reach. So call early in the day, before 8 a.m., before the palace guards arrive. You'll need your prospect's direct number, and here's a sneaky way to get it. Suppose the company's main number is 555-5000. You should call 555-5012. When someone says, "Good morning, Pam Johnson," you should innocently say, "Oops, somebody here must have written this down wrong. I was calling for Tom Frederick. What's his direct number?" If the very next thing you hear isn't Pam giving you Tom's number, it may be, "Good morning, Tom Frederick." For more tips for job seekers and getting better results in all your day-to-day communication, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
Seditious Sirens is up next, live after the news on the Liberty Radio Network.